Like the rest of the country, Houston has flown its colors solemnly but proudly these last 2 weeks. Tonight, the city will make room in its mood for remembering victims and for celebrating the return of one of its great loves, football, as Texas meets Houston.
University of Houston is honored to have Ms. Catherine Chazinski, world-renowned soprano and vocal chair of the University of Houston's Moore School of Music, to lead our national anthem. Ms. Chazinski has performed throughout the world, most recently seen on the network performance of Little Women. Please rise and join Ms. Chazinski and the spirit of Houston as we honor America in the playing and singing of our national anthem. Etched in our memory. Please stand silently for a moment of reflection and respect. Words cannot express the tremendous grief our nation is experiencing over the tragedies in New York, Washington, D.C., and Pennsylvania. We mourn the loss of lives and the injuries sustained in this brutal attack on our nation. We commend the heroic actions and courage of many rescue workers, volunteers, and government officials. In the words of our congressional leaders, we, the people of the United States, will stand united as our nation begins the process of recovering from this national tragedy. Please join in a moment of silence. Let us show the world our dedication to our great land as we raise our voices and demonstrate the power and fortitude of our country's determination to move forward. Let freedom ring from the mountaintops to the valleys. Let freedom ring here in Robertson Stadium at John O'Quinn Field. Let no place on earth not hear the voice of America. Good will prevail, freedom will ring. Please join Catherine Chazinski and the Spirit of Houston band as we sing God Bless America.
Thank you. ESPN2's presentation of Primetime College Football is brought to you by Budweiser. With the crisp, clean, refreshing taste you'll find in no other beer. And by Verizon Wireless. Call 1-800-255-9595 to cast your vote for the Monday Night Football 20,000-point challenge.
Robertson Stadium, the campus of the University of Houston, and the renewal of a longtime rivalry between two former Southwest Conference members, sixth-ranked Texas, here to visit the Cougars of the U of H. And welcome to Houston. Dave Barnett joined by Dean Blevins. I think we're in agreement. It was right not to play football last week, and it feels just as right to have football back this week.
I think you're exactly right. In terms of football, you've got to play with energy. You have to play with emotion. You have to play with focus. None of that would have been around a week ago.
Texas is looking at this season as one in which they have everything set up in their favor to make a national championship run, and yet, Dean, they have taken proven results at the most important position on the field and put them on the bench, and they're starting potential at quarterback.
Sort of like they're betting the ranch. You know, you have a Big 12 player of the year in Major Applewhite. You sit him. Chris Sims has tremendous potential. And they're banking on it. Start number 10 for him tonight.
No such controversy at Houston, where the entire roster has one collective start at quarterback, and that was Kelly Robertson 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, and his first start or last start since then, 5 years ago. He was a junior college baseball player, so he gets his second start in 5 years.
Let's meet the third member of our crew on the sidelines tonight, Holly Rowe.
Thank you, Dave. This rivalry started back in 1968, but right now it's very one-sided, a rivalry really only for the University of Houston. They are playing this game on their own campus, but they are outnumbered by Longhorn fans. Dana Dimmel, the coach of Houston, is trying to build a program. He turned down big money offers to move this game elsewhere, said we have to play on campus. Houston is a huge recruiting area for them and the University of Texas. 26 players on the Longhorn rosters are from Houston in this area. This is a big game for Mack Brown because he's in the heart of his recruiting area.
And Mack Brown, in his fourth year as the head coach at UT, 29 wins, 11 losses, 2-0 start. He has him ranked sixth in the country, trying to bring them home in the top 10, something Texas has not done in 18 years. And Texas ready to receive the opening kickoff from Dustin Bell. Bell has it teed up. Passes down to the Longhorn roster. Victor Ike has dropped back deep for the Longhorns, along with Irvis Hill. And 4 yards deep, Hill will accept the touchback, and so Texas goes to work. And the junior from Franklin Lakes, New Jersey, Chris Sims, who led the Big 12 in pass efficiency last year, off to a somewhat unimpressive start statistically, but we'll talk about why that is. He has Trissel and Williams getting his first start at tailback. Edwards, Roy Williams, and B.J. Johnson, arguably the most dangerous receiving core in the country that Sims has to pick from. So far in 2001, only 50% through the air for a modest 349 yards, but no interceptions. Two touchdowns and right to the air on the first snap, and it is batted down. As he tried to go to Matt Trissel, Robin Trombley got a hand on it. Up front, Robbie Doan held Julius Peppers of North Carolina without a tackle, much less a sack. Holloway, Anderson, Kirk Hughes, and Williams complete the front line. And up front for the Cougars, Lee, Trombley, Hill, and Ingersoll, who's the best of that front four. Second down and 10. With Texas going with three wides and a lone setback behind Sims. Look for four wides, sometimes an empty backfield, and five wide receivers tonight. And Williams, who has earned the starting job with good productivity in the first two games, over tackle for five. Only two linebackers for the Cougars. They're Gissen, Danner, and Davis, and they play a five-man secondary, including three safeties. Jason Parker, the best cover man. Victor Malone, the other corner, and Hannick Milligan. They feel probably a pro future for him, although they're high on his brother Hammond as well. From North Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Third and five for Texas. Here is the five wide look. And nobody behind Sims. Protected well, now scrambling. And pulls up, fires complete, and Texas will have its first down of the day as Kyle Shanahan brings in the catch.
Chris Sims likes to get out of the pocket. Yeah, he's 6'5 and 225, and you'd think the prototypical dropback passer, but a good example here of him on his horse around the corner. And, you know, Dave, he was pretty calm there. He's made mistakes in the past in situations like that. He's one for one in that department.
Shanahan, the son of Mike, head coach of the Broncos. And Texas has borrowed that five wide out look from the Denver offensive system. This time Williams on a draw and met, but breaks the ankle tackle of Lee Ingersoll and out across the 35-yard line. Dana Dimmel took over last year. Had a 3-8 season, lost a disappointing opener 3 weeks ago, 21-14 to Rice. But he says this program at Houston is this close, holding up his fingers about an inch apart to turning the corner and getting things moved in the right direction.
Well, he loves his recruiting base. He had a very good recruiting class last year, but it takes time.
Williams fights for 4 yards, takes it right side, and cuts it back close to the first down marker. Ivan Williams, Diesel, they call him, 6'1", 235 with speed, and averaging nearly 6 yards per carry in the first two games.
Yeah, he is a big, strong back. I was down in Austin the other day, and I thought he was a guard until I saw the number on his back. He will be sharing time with Cedric Benson, the much ballyhooed true freshman. He'll be in early. I would assume he'd be in the first quarter, Dave.
They said early in the first quarter. We are early, but we haven't seen him yet. And Williams did pick up another first down. So from the 43, they come after Sims. And again, the pass deflected at the line of scrimmage as he tried to go to Shanahan.
You know, he gets more balls batted for a 6'5 quarterback than any other quarterback I've ever seen. And it's not as though he throws, you know, that three-quarter look. He's over the top, plenty. And I think that was it Hill that got it? One of the newcomers up front that got it. He doesn't do as good a job of finding lanes as, and I'm not going to compare him to Major Applewhite all night, but he needs to find some lanes.
Couple of completions, but two batted down already for Sims. Another draw play for Williams, and this time a big hole. And it takes more than one to bring him down. He's at the Houston 46-yard line, a gain of 11. Hannick Milligan needed the help of Jason Parker to corral the Diesel.
The problem is when you blitz, if you don't get him right there, big gains. Williams hard to tackle, and Dana Dimmel telling us yesterday, if Texas can run the ball here early, it could be a long game for them.
That was his big fear, that Texas could just overpower them with talent and not have to throw. Sims throwing here and incomplete. On one attended for B.J. Johnson, the sophomore from Grand Prairie, Texas. Now, Mac Brown's big fear, Dean, was that Houston, with nothing to lose, everything to gain, would pull out the stop from their playbook, gamble, maybe make a big special teams play early, get an early lead, and ride emotion and momentum the rest of the night.
Well, I think Houston has to win the intangibles, and there you see Mac Brown, what a job he has done at Texas. But I think clearly Houston has to win the intangibles, the turnover advantage, the kicking game, the penalty area.
Second and 10. This one on target, the game down to the 42-yard line, and Bo Scaife, who has battled a couple of knee reconstructions, one in high school in Denver, one after his first collegiate practice at Texas.
Yeah, what an unfortunate break there. Houston will allow that, though. You get Texas in third and relatively long, Jason Parker. You've got to make the nice tackle if you're going to give them the short stuff, and he did on that last one.
Scaife for the second catch of the year, and he sets up third and 7. Houston not wanting to blitz a lot early. And they don't hear, and Sims has all day, finally over the middle on a strike for a first down to the 28-yard line. Sloan Thomas for 15 yards.
You called it. The key to that play was the terrific protection from the offensive line. Sloan Thomas held there, but Chris Sims had plenty of time to hold it, and wait for Sloan Thomas over the middle.
Sloan Thomas overshadowed by Williams and Johnson. As a freshman, 9 catches, but he averaged 23 yards on those 9. And 3 went for touchdowns. This one goes for a first down. And again, they try Ivan Williams up the middle, and only a couple this time.
This is a big series right here. If Houston could hold Texas, force them to a relatively long field goal, get out with 3 or nothing, that would be a heck of a lot better than starting 7-0 down and losing some confidence.
Second down at 8. Texas has converted both of its third down opportunities on this drive.
Another check.
And they give to Williams. Through an ankle tackle. And then they get him right at about the 24. Actually, Victor Ike slips into the backfield and gets his first carry.
Both of the audibles so far for Sims have been to runs. He's seen the numbers that give him the notion that the run is there. That time, good tackling by Houston. Sims has done a better job of that, though. You know, we talked about it earlier, Dave. It seems like yesterday he came in. He's a junior.
He's a junior who a lot of people thought might transfer if he didn't get the starting job this year. He says, I never thought about transferring. I did think about redshirting. So yeah. I would have 2 full years to start if the coaches had gone back to Applewell. So on third down, again, Tom steps up. Lucky that wasn't intercepted and returned for 6 by Justin Davis. I mean, really lucky.
Houston all over that play. Good study by the coaches from Houston to know what was going to happen on that play. You're exactly right. That's a newcomer for Houston. Justin Davis almost picked off Chris Sims there and could have gone the distance.
Sims had that happen way too often last year, including first game, first play of this game in Austin a year ago. So they're going to try a 41-yard field goal. Dusty Mangum, who has been perfect, a walk-on freshman, stays perfect. He's 6 out of 6. And Texas gets points, 9:52 in the first quarter. They have a 3-0 lead. Coming down to the taking the opening kick, 56 yards, 41 yard
I'll do it for them. I do it for the fans.
There's only one way to burn, with the best-selling CD burning software in the world, Easy CD Creator 5 from Roxio.
Texas taking the opening kick, 56 yards, 41-yard Dusty Mangum field goal, and they lead 3-0. And now Dan Smith is set to kick it off for the Horns. This is a short high kick coming down to the 14-yard line. And Bobby Tillman on the return for the Cougars up to the 31. So Houston now with Kelly Robertson, a junior college catcher and a pretty good hitter, a 439 average, but he went with football finally, and he's got Baldwin and Reynolds behind him. He's got Thompson, Bell, and Iglesias, and a receiver corps that's almost the equal of Texas. I might say here in Houston, they are the equal. They are deep, they're big, very productive last year, but that was with Jason McKinley. And after he graduated, they had 0 experience at that position, and so there was an opportunity for a transfer from Western Kentucky and Dixie College, who had not played football since his high school senior year, 1996, in Fort Neches, Texas, to walk right in and win the job, and that's what Kelly Robertson did. He admits against Rice, nervous at the outset. He finally settled down late, felt pretty good about things in the second half, but fell just short, 21-14. And the Cougars from their 31 out of the shotgun. Their first play is a swing pass, and a nice one-handed catch is made by Joffrey Reynolds out of the backfield. They'll run him. He's a good blocker, and he caught 24 passes last year. The offensive line for Houston, about a 300-pounder, not real tall as a group. Chris Redding, the brother of Corey Redding, the Texas defensive end, had not James Watson Beauford complete their front group. And Texas with Chris's brother, Gordon Tubbs and Thornton. Not nearly as big at the tackle spots, but more athletic than last year's outstanding tandem, Casey Hampton and Sean Rogers, who are high NFL draft picks. Lee Penn into the backfield after one play, and the first carry for the Cougars. Pretty hard-fought second effort by Penn as he drags D.D. Lewis to the 43-yard line and enough for a Cougar first down. Texas linebackers Jones, Lewis, and Rawls. Lewis as productive as they've had in their long proud history in the middle. But the strength of their defense, the secondary, they led the nation in pass efficiency defense last year. Jammer, most field, the best cornerback in the country. Jammer there. Robertson's got to find him every play. Lee Penn, senior from North Miami Beach, for a couple. Houston, a strong Florida recruiting presence under previous head coach Kim Helton, who played his college ball in Florida.
Well, those aren't bad states to recruit from. I guess if you can go down to Bradenton and Broward County and get down in Florida, but sneak back to Texas.
David Dimmel coming from Wyoming said when he got the job, he was staying at a downtown hotel, looked out his window, and realized he was looking at more potential recruits than in the entire state that he just left behind. Robertson's pass intended for surprised Orlando Iglesias just turned around, and it was already past him. And let's send it down to Holly Rowe.
Houston coach Dana Dimmel told us that mood and momentum was important early here against Texas. And so far, his team is very upbeat. That stop on defense preventing a touchdown for the defense, they were celebrating. Their big disappointment, though, they felt they did not wrap up on Ivan Williams. They thought he gained too many yards. Their big focus on their next series would be to wrap it up.
Focus right now, pick up a third down. Not a strength for the Cougars in 2000. Texas comes out with a blitz. It's picked up. The ball is too tall. Again, headed for Iglesias, who was covered by Roderick Babers.
You know, there were a couple of things that happened, though, for Houston that they have to be pleased with. First of all, they picked up a first down or two, but they had a chance to complete those last two balls. I thought that Robertson would not have time to throw, and he did both on both plays.
All right, man to watch all night, as North Carolina found out. Nathan Vasher, who set a Big 12 and Texas single-game punt return record 2 weeks ago, 153 yards, including a 44-yard touchdown. And they don't kick away from him. Vasher with that knack to make the first man miss. And to the 27, a 13-yard return this time of a 40-yard punt by Jimmy McCleary. And Texas leading 3-0. We'll take it for the second time on offense with 8:01 in the first quarter. Three nothing Texas, 8:01 in the first quarter. Texas penalized for a block in the back very late after that return by Vasher, so they're going to start off at their 8-yard line after this mark off. And Chris Sims, who took him 56 yards for a field goal on the opening drive, again with three wideouts. And well protected. Looks up wide open is Johnson. It's a foot race with Jason Parker, and B.J. Johnson is going to win it, and it's 92 yards for a touchdown. for B.J. Johnson. That's a long one. He has averaged 52 yards per touchdown catch in his very brief Texas career.
Well, he beat Jason Parker, and we'll see it in a moment. Parker, the best cover man for Houston. That one not even close, though.
Mangum now 9 of 9 on PATs, and BJ's got a story to tell after this one. Could not have been more open.
Yeah, Parker lets him get by as though he has help on top, and he doesn't have help on top. And then it's a foot race. B.J. Johnson can run. Well, you can't make a mistake like that anywhere on the field, but certainly not that far away from home. Center field goes with a tight end. What a mistake and a great job by Sims and B.J. Johnson in taking advantage of that mistake.
Let's head to the studio and check in with Reese Davis.
Dave, this is a little shorter pass for SMU against North Carolina State. It's a 19-17 game. Kellen Luker, under all kinds of pressure, just trying to get rid of it, threw it backwards. Went off the referee. George Anderson recovered NC State, about to beat the Mustangs. It's 26-17 with just kicks to go. It's over now. It's a final.
Oh, unlucky bounce. SMU play the Wolfpack close. Texas 10, Houston nothing. 7:47, first quarter. They move very methodically, set it for three, and then one snap, and 92 yards, and a touchdown. Another return by Tillman, who turned it left, found a nice wall of blockers all the way to the 40-yard line, a 24-yard return. ESPN Sunday Night Football comes your way tomorrow night, 8:30 Eastern, 5:30 Pacific. Brian Griese and the Denver Broncos heading to the desert to face Jake Plummer and the Arizona Cardinals. The coverage begins with NFL Primetime presented by Miller Lite at 7:30 Eastern.
All right, it's important for Houston to come out, not lose their poise, go back to what they were doing the first series, gain a first down or two. They actually, on that last possession, had great protection. They dropped a pass and then overthrew that pass. Main thing right now is poise.
Good field position to start this drive. As Kikoa Bell goes in motion. And they give up the middle for Reynolds. And Joffrey fights his way for about 9 yards. Junior from Tyler, Texas. Their leading rusher with 534 yards a year ago, and 201 of that in one game against Army.
Joffrey, a threat to come out of the backfield. I know the linebackers are keying on that because he is such a good receiver.
Texas defense among the top seven in the country last year. First against the pass, almost as impressive against the run, and they screw this run out by Reynolds. And he has one late burst to get to Texas territory and pick up the first down before he's knocked down by Jammer.
He put that one in overdrive. Texas had him running side to side, exactly where they wanted it, but a little overdrive by Reynolds for the first.
Now, what's impressive about the defense is what Carl Reese has done with it. 3 years after they were 92nd in pass defense nationally, all the way to first, and 56th in total defense the year he took it over. Seventh last year.
Great matchup right down here. That's Iglesias lined up against Jammer. That's where they're going.
Robertson going deep, going right at Jammer, and the catch is made, but out of bounds by Brian Robinson. Actually, they both got turned around a little bit. And if Robertson puts it over Robinson's other shoulder, this may go all the way.
That's a good call. That's a good call. Jammer had, of course, the sideline as an extra man there. Nice throw. Jammer's just as good a cornerback as there is in the country and probably the best. Number six, you'll see a star tonight.
He says, best I have been around at man coverage. He's as strong as our linebackers. Fast as the fastest wideouts. A little bit too fast that time.
Free play.
And the same thing. A flag time, and then they get offensive interference for Robinson pulling at Jammer to try and keep him from intercepting it. Corey Redding, however, definitely jumping. We'll see if perhaps he was drawn off. Conference USA officiating crew headed by R.G. Detillier.
There's a lot going on this play now, Dave.
They've got a little to sort out.
I don't think Houston drew Texas offside. I think it was a Texas offside, and then I don't know on the tail end if it was offensive or defense.
Offside, defense. Interference, defense. Yeah.
Brown begs to differ, and most of the crowd here on the U of H campus not liking that call because they're mostly wearing orange.
Well, the first call was good. Let's see. The second is Jammer pushing off. That's a bad call. If anything, offensive pass interference. Bad call goes against Texas.
Brown wouldn't have much argument with 5 yards for Redding offsides. He doesn't like this at all. The 33 of the Longhorns now first and 10 Houston. And more flags.
Houston has been a highly penalized team, but not recently, huh, Dave?
It's one thing Dimmel has really worked on changing. Emphasizing individual discipline and avoiding penalties.
Snap. Ball start. Offense.
That's only 5 yards, Dean, but that could be a momentum killer.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Texas comes out now with momentum, and that was a good call. You've got to think, though, it's like the NBA, sort of a makeup call coming. You know we're going to have some more jump balls. That's the way this sandlot game is these days. And, again, that was a bad call that went against Texas.
Houston likes the jump balls to 6'3", Iglesias, 6'4", Robinson. Shotgun. A roll and another toss to Reynolds. And Reynolds all the way up the left sideline for a touchdown. Designed for short yardage, it goes 38 yards and gets Houston on the board.
This play was actually like a shovel pass. Like a little screen. And what speed we see from Reynolds.
Two lightning quick touchdown drives. Jeff Patterson adding the PAT. Well, we told you Reynolds was multifaceted. He's shown it, and he's got the Cougars within three. Kelly Robertson, what looked like he was supposed to shovel to Reynolds, he has to arc over the defender, but he'll take the result.
Take a look right there. That's D.D. Lewis. He gets beat by Beaufort. Look at him. All tied up. And no one actually touches Reynolds with that terrific speed. But Lewis beaten on that play badly by Beaufort.
Everett Rawls had a shot at him, but a futile grab at the ankles.
It's a great example of your offensive lineman getting outside, getting downfield. Great agility.
That kick has not quite reached the end zone. Meanwhile, one more look at the Houston score.
Well, this is the old upside down option. It's what Coach Dimmel called it yesterday. Just lobbed a little shot put, a little free throw over. You have to freelance a little bit, and that's a great job of freelancing by Robertson.
Let's go down to Holly.
Mack Brown was very positive to his defense just then. He said, look, give Houston credit for the plays they make, but you've got to concentrate on tackling better. If you would have tackled behind the line, they never would have made the play in the first place.
Well, he makes the point after Houston makes the big play. Right back in it, 10-7. With only four plays, 60 yards. 92-yarder, by the way. Sims to Johnson, the fourth longest pass play in Texas history. This time they go short to the tight end Scaife, upended but close to a first down pickup. As Jason Parker came up, he was the man burned by B.J. Johnson on the last play.
Trombley does a poor job here. Look at Trombley trailing the play. He's the defensive end. He's supposed to make the containment. he doesn't do that, and big play Texas, nice execution.
Sims going to his best buddy perhaps on the entire team, Chris Sims. They've both predicted big years out of one another this year. It was enough for a first after the 46. Texas State mostly three wides, one of the backfield. Johnson brought down by Justin Davis. Let's check in with Reese Davis.
All right, Dave, San Diego State and Colorado State. 7-0 Aztecs with the lead, and Adam Hall firing a dart to Derek Lewis. 38-yard completion that set up a touchdown to make it 14-0. But Bradley Van Pelt has an answer, and the answer is Heath Redstock. Bought some time to it in there beautifully. 14-7 game.
One of the best relatively unknown receivers in the country right there, Heath Redstock. Johnson got him five this time. Second and five. Just into Houston territory. And absolutely no gain this time. As Ivan Williams met quickly. Heard Robinson coming up from strong safety.
Ryan Hill.
What is behind the five defensive back philosophy for Houston?
Stop the run. I mean, it's almost as if, as Greg Davis said, people don't even count the pass anymore, but teams are dedicated to stopping the run. It doesn't matter if you have 9 or 10 people at the line of scrimmage. Dick Bumpus has done that everywhere he's been.
Williams actually losing one, so 3rd and 6. Sims with the check at the line. Any time on the play clock. Down to 2 as he gets the snap. They're coming after him, and he finds a hot receiver. I don't think Shanahan has enough for the first unless they give him a friendly spot.
Well, that's close. I think he does. I think that's a good spot. That's perfect execution right there. An audible Shanahan. Little slant. That ball was thrown on a rope.
And, you know, a couple of the Cougar defenders this week were not exactly shy about saying that they much prefer to play against Chris Sims than Major Applewhite, saying that they don't think Sims, with his lack of experience, can make decisions like that one at the line. This is Cedric Benson's first carry of the night. We do see him in the first quarter, and Benson picking up 3. This is arguably the most accomplished high school football player in the history of the state of Texas.
There's Dick Bumpus. Yeah, Dick Bumpus out of Fort Smith, Arkansas. I used to see him play with the Razorbacks. He was a great player for Arkansas. He and Brad Veto calling the defense for Houston. He is a great young, great man and a great coach. Certainly a great young man. He's not a great young man.
Like to hear that.
Middle agent.
Sims again all day to hang one deep. And this one is on target at the goal line. And it is incomplete. Incomplete is the call. Tony Jeffrey, redshirt freshman from here in Houston, arguing along with Roy Williams that he made that catch right at the goal line against Victor Malone.
Another takeoff route. Well, that's close. That is really close. Now, he acts as though he does not make it. Jeffrey, that usually indicates that it's a good call, but that was very close. Ball right on the money, Dave.
If he has control, breaking that proverbial plane, doesn't matter what happens after that.
You say it was good?
I said probably not. I think good call.
I'm with you.
So 3rd and 7. Perfectly thrown ball, almost in second touchdown. This time again for Jeffrey, and he overthrew it.
Threw to the wrong man. That's a force. Overthrew it also. Had a man wide open.
Big sigh of Cougar relief as they finally force a Texas punt. Ryan Bradford, junior college transfer out of Trinity Valley. We'll try to hang Houston somewhere inside their 10. End over end pooch.
Good kick.
And right out about the 10, as a matter of fact. Key Bell lets it go out of bounds at the 12. Start your Sunday morning off right, 11 Eastern, 8 Pacific. NFL Countdown gets you ready for all the day's games. Chris Berman, Stuart Scott, Tom Jackson, Sterling Sharp, Steve Young, and Chris Mortensen. Bring you up to the minute news and stats right up until kickoff. NFL Countdown tomorrow, 11 Eastern on ESPN.
I have a feeling we'll see some better tackling here by the Longhorns. Watching the tape of the North Carolina game, they were sloppy quite a bit in the first half. They came out of that second half, Dave, and were ferocious tacklers. And after missing the tackle on the sideline, let's look for some good defense here.
Well, as Holly told us, Matt Brown wasted not a second to make that very point after the touchdown. And again, it's Reynolds dealing Texas misery in the first quarter. 20 yards. Right off tackle to the 32.
Dana Demmel, looking like reverse, holds the defense. Redding has no idea at defensive end. And if you hesitate as a defensive player, that running back has an opportunity, and Joffrey Reynolds would take advantage of it.
Fourth carry, 37 yards. Texas all about movement on their defensive front line. Every once in a while, Houston thinks they can take advantage of that. Fighting hard on his first carry against his former team, Chris Robertson, out of Denison, signed with Texas. Played there 2 years, transferred, sat out last year.
Carl Reese from Texas is just a terrific defensive coordinator. Here's Greg Davis, offensive. Right there is Carl Reese. He's a guy who, as he says, he spins down his players. He takes the defensive back with speed. He moves him down to linebacker, linebacker down to defensive end down to defensive lineman to get speed on the field.
Robertson on second and seven. Iglesias and immediately knocked down by Babers. Find out about Auburn and Syracuse now. Reese Davis.
Well, Dave, Syracuse is showing some offense we haven't seen from the Orangemen all year. Already up 14-7 the third quarter. James Mungrove goes in for the second time, and Syracuse now with a 21-7 lead about halfway through the third.
Wow, Syracuse finally finding their offense. Winding down in the first quarter, and Robertson looking at a third and two. Another short toss intended for Iglesias. Babers right on it. Ball thrown slightly behind him, and he can't bring it in.
Houston, if they're going to stay in this game and have a chance to win it, that combination has to be better. Robertson to Iglesias has got to be their whole card.
And so far, one catch, 5 yards. All Iglesias has in the first quarter. So McCleary get on to punt. Transferred from Hofstra. He was a high school quarterback at the Woodlands just north of here. A strong Houston presence on both these rosters, and this one will take a Texas bounce. A big one, in fact.
Well, that's poor coverage. Houston was down in position and gave up about 10 yards back to Texas.
That's only a 28-yarder from McCleary. 23 seconds for Texas to work with.
You know what that is? It's a first down. You know, 10 yards right there is just a first down. The punt play is just so vital in this game. And we mentioned off the top that Houston has to win the turnover advantage, the kick game, the penalties. They've got to win the intangible game to have a chance to win this against a very talented Texas club.
So from the 34. Offset eye in the backfield this time. And again, Sims has a man open deep and just off the fingertips of Williams.
It started to say that if you notice right before the snap, Chris Sims looked out to the right. He got his guy, Roy Williams, on nothing but a takeoff. And barely outthrows Roy Williams. Could have been one of those days that if you don't reach out until a little bit later on that, maybe you catch it. But lots of speed, but not enough.
Williams had kind of a frustrating first two plus games.
What a stallion.
Like if Michelangelo came back and decided to sculpt a wide receiver, he would need Roy Williams as his mark. 6'5", 210. Breaking tackles across midfield to the 48 of Houston. A gain of 17 as they give it to Tony Jeffrey, the wideout.
Well, a little misdirection there, a little reverse that goes to Jeffrey, stopping the pursuit of Houston. Probably a combination there of Jeffrey with nice moves, but sloppy tackling from Houston.
End of the first quarter on offense. Texas leading 10-7 at Robertson Stadium on the campus of the University of Houston. Second quarter now in Houston. Texas leading 10-7. Dave Barnett, Dean Blevins, and Holly Rowe. Robertson Stadium. In the last few years, the past and future home of Houston Cougar football, moving back on campus from the Astrodome a few years back. Texas starts 49 of the Cougars. Sims again looking deep. This time Roy Williams with a step on everybody and batted away at the goal line. Stanford route preventing the most recent near Texas touchdown. First quarter, big plays were the story. 92-yarder, the fourth longest pass play in Texas history. B.J. Johnson getting behind Jason Parker. At that point, 10-0 Texas. Houston comes back with a 38-yard screen for Joffrey Reynolds. And a nice bit of tiptoeing down the left sideline. Texas with 189 total yards, including the carry by Jeffrey to end the quarter.
If you're home, and almost asleep, wake up. Bombs away. They're going bombs all day long now, looking to run.
Fake to Jeffrey that time, and the pitch is fumbled. And Texas looked like they had it first and then maybe had it ripped away, and they may have it back again. It may have changed hands two or three times under that pile. And it will be Texas hanging on. Let's check in again. Auburn, Syracuse, Reese.
All right, Dave, and the Syracuse defense really putting the heat on the redshirt freshman quarterback, Jason Campbell. You see Freeney's back there, but Simmons rides him out of the play, but Campbell still throws a terrible pass. It's picked off by LaTroy Oliver. It's 21-7. Syracuse trying to cash in on the turnover.
Well, Williams fumbled it. Texas very vanilla by their own admission on purpose first two games, and now starting to open up a little more of the playbook. Near disaster that time, though.
I don't know how much of a playbook it is. It just, you go long.
Third and nine. And Sims with a marker down. Drop for a loss of one.
In the area of the hold, but I didn't see a hold. Yeah, that's what it is.
R.G. DeTillier saw one. Boy, but you're right. Every second or third play now, this is what the Houston defenders said they saw out of Sims.
Penalty refused. Fuck down.
He looks up and sees who he thinks has the best matchup. And you can call it street ball or sandlot ball if you want, but they've gotten one big play and two nearly going for six.
71, Doan right there. I'm trying to circle. Left arm, there it was. You know, you can call holding on every play, Dave. That was ticky-tacky, but it was a play that didn't impact the game because Sims was stopped anyway.
Bobby Doan, who just 2 weeks ago matched up with maybe the best pass rusher in college football, Julius Peppers of North Carolina, held him without a tackle. Bell on the return. 2-29. 31 yards all Bradford got on that punt. 10-7 Texas early in the second. 13-33 in the second. Houston taking over, trailing 10-7. Dana Dimmel, known for passing offense at Wyoming, 93 total yards. And Matt Brown saw 92 of that total for Texas on one play, almost half their total production. Houston will give to Ethan Ross after the fake up the middle. junior out of Provo, Utah, like Robertson, a transfer from Dixie College in the state of Utah.
You know, Robertson, the quarterback, is doing a good job with the football. He's nifty with it. It's hard to really tell who has the football. These little reverses and traps.
A five-year layoff to play junior college baseball. Can you imagine how long it would take for the mechanics and the speed of the game to come back to you after that game?
Winky Ferris at A&M. Now we have Robertson. That's in vogue.
Quincy Carter. Reynolds doing it again. Into the Texas secondary. And a first down to the 42-yard line for Joffrey Reynolds.
Casey Hampton, Sean Rogers gone from the interior of the Texas defense. Some people have said that's a vulnerable spot. There you see Anderson not able to be in position. Good tackle late by Ahmad Brooks, but it was in the secondary.
Tubbs and Gordon, smaller, quicker, maybe overall better athletes than Rogers and Hampton, but couldn't find two better in the country than those two last year. They again run that end around, and Texas ready for it this time. Jermaine Anderson, Tyrone Jones. Tyrone Jones, senior from Texas City. They got four members of his high school 4A state championship team, all to sign to play defense for Texas. Texas City just a few miles from here.
He's one of those guys you'd call, what is it, an all-bus team? I'm telling you what, that guy at 6'4", about 244, as a linebacker, he's pretty intimidating. Number 39, right down here.
Loss of two. Flags, but no whistle.
Three down.
And so the free play is a deep completion for Houston out of the 26-yard line. Brandon Middleton for 34 yards.
Really wise. Very smart by Kelly Robertson and the entire Houston club, Dave.
Texas jumped and then stopped, but there was never a whistle. Marcus Tubbs is the Longhorn defensive lineman jumping off sides.
Offside. Defense.
Was it contact?
Penalty
right?
Results in a play. First down.
So they jump. No contact. Play continues. Texas suspended a little bit defensively. And Houston nails him for it.
Now, that's a guy who hadn't played quarterback except one game since 1996, and he has that kind of awareness.
Yeah, that type of presence. Dana Dimmel is a very good offensive coach.
Again, Reynolds finds room up the middle. 5'10", 215-pounder. Seen his speed, and now we see a good bit of his power, about 8 yards. Everett Rawls making the tackle.
Houston's found something it likes. And they're going to keep it up until Texas shows them otherwise.
Well, they definitely felt that was the area to test first.
Yeah.
New defensive tackles.
Yeah.
Reynolds has 50 yards on just 6 carries and a 38-yard touchdown catch. Bell in motion. And this time, no gain for Joffrey.
Blitz in the gap, no chance for Houston. And that'll bring up one of those big third down opportunities that games turn on.
And the demo said we've got to find our running game. They had 7 yards rushing against Rice. So they were the last ranked rush offense in the country statistically coming into this game. 13 yards rushing last year against Texas. Haven't picked up a third down yet tonight. This would be a good time for him to start. Robertson with time steps up and again overthrows Iglesias.
Had his man.
And then Iglesias, in frustration, takes it out on Ahmad Brooks. But
he's lucky there's no penalty. Yeah, lucky no penalty. No discipline at all by Iglesias. And once again, Houston has an opportunity, Dave. They've just been overthrowing those. Robertson is high and outside as a catcher. I don't know if he'd catch that one. You know, that'd be going to the backstop.
If you're stealing on him, that's into center field, and you're all the way to third base. And it's always when he's trying to hit Iglesias. That's added to his frustration. So Jeff Patterson lining up a 36-yarder. And it's blocked. Rolling dead at the one, Tyrone Jones reaching up for Texas.
Well, it's no points for Houston, but it's the next best thing. They get it all the way back.
Another big special teams play for Texas. Here.
Of Texas, Ricky Williams. Ricky, a lot of changes at running back for Texas this week. What's your take so far on their young guys?
Well, they're all doing a great job. You know, they're trying to get all of them a little bit of experience and see how they do against this defense.
I know you feel so close to the Longhorns as part of your family. Was it important for you to be here this week and support the guys?
Well, we had an off week, and it was a short drive to Houston, so I just hopped in my car and came down for him. I knew Cedric especially wanted to meet me, so I came down for him especially, but to see all the guys play.
Have you given him any tips so far?
Well, I haven't had a chance to see him run in person, but I'm sure after today I'll have a lot of advice for him.
All right, thanks very much.
Well, just had a chance to see him carry for 1 yard. Cedric Benson is at Texas mostly because he idolized Ricky Williams. All the while he was at Midland Lee, he was keeping an eye on the man who finished his career in Austin as the number one ground gainer in college football history. Wanted to follow in his footsteps, and now he's doing it. But he is being crowded on his first two or three carries. Ricky Williams can look back at the statistical highlight to his career, and it was culminated in the biggest game every year for Texas against Texas A&M right here, the record-breaking run in Austin in a 26-24 Longhorn win his senior year, 1998. Tony Dorsett's record, he was right there on the Texas sideline to congratulate the new record holder, who then saw Ron Dane of Wisconsin break his record shortly thereafter. Benson, two carries for 4 yards, third and six. And Sims, short toss over the middle. Couple of broken tackles for Brett Robin. And he ends up with a hard-fought 11 yards.
Well, a couple of things. Number one, terrific run after the catch. And if you're Brett Robin and you come into the game, you want to make it, you want to take advantage of the opportunity. So that's what you saw there. Defensively, you know what's going to happen if he comes into the lineup. You've got to say 25, 25, 25. Look out for him. Poor recognition by Houston that time. And on that kick, Dave, it was inside the 20-yard line by about a foot.
Right.
If it were outside the 20-yard line on that kick, it would have indeed been downed at the 1-yard line.
Texas will call its first timeout, 7:43 in the first quarter. And a thin 10-7 lead for overwhelming favorite coming in.
ESPN2's presentation of Primetime College Football is brought to you by Nissan, who reassures you that the cure is coming. And by Verizon Wireless. Call 1-800-255-9595 to cast your vote for the Monday Night Football 20,000-point challenge.
Well, in some ways, this will get Texas ready for the Red River Shootout in a couple weeks, because they're in another stadium that's about 50% red, 50% orange. Texas first and 10 after their timeout, midway in the second quarter. And Sims rolling on a play fake. Pulls up off the hands of Shanahan. Let's check in on UNLV with Reese Davis.
Taking on John Makovic's Arizona Wildcats, and Jason Johnson completing better than 66% of his passes this year. Nobody's caught more than Bobby Wade, but that's the first time he's gotten in the house this year, and the Cats are on top of the Rebs, 7-0.
Former Texas coach John Makovic. 50 through the air, again 92 on the one play, the touchdown from Sims to B.J. Johnson. Sims another check at the line. Houston players felt this would not be a strength of his. They wanted to see him because they felt his lack of experience would show up. And he gets him into a play that gains about 9 yards for Ivan Williams right up the middle. Heard Robinson and Arthur Gissendaner bring him down. How about you? I was surprised that a huge underdog was talking like a couple of them. Cougar defenders
yeah.
were.
Well, though, a couple of them were junior college players that hadn't been around too long. Houston's been known as a place that, let's just say that those types of comments have been made before and no one's really cared, but Dana Dimmel is changing things.
Adrian Lee handed Milligan specifically. Say, yeah, we don't want to see Appleway. He's better. Short yardage. And enough for the decent Williams. Leads the 47 and another first down. And it's Haddock Milligan making the tackle.
This guy's going to be a strong back, short yardage, and he's going to surprise some people bouncing off tackles. He has surprising speed. Texas has four backs they can run in and out of there. Benson, Ike, Robin, Williams. And they all give you a little something different. Ike, I believe, in there now.
Victor Ike, fastest man on the team, but averaging just 3.4 yards per carry in the first two games, so replaced as the starter tonight by Williams. Sims again all day and throws it to Stanford Rout. True freshman from Pflugerville, Texas, returns it to the Texas 48-yard line. First interception of the season for Sims. And a flag down. They are high on Rout, who played about half the snaps of his first college game against Rice. And it is against Texas, and it stands for Dana Dimmel and the Cougars.
Well, this is both what Dana Dimmel had said specifically he wanted to have happen. They wanted to put Chris Sims in situations where they got pressure on him and made him pick out receivers and make the play. And on the other hand, Greg Davis is trying to get him in situations he can be successful in. That's not his best situation. It's not his strong suit.
Rout over there with something big to celebrate. His first collegiate interception, and from the 47, Houston, starting with Reynolds. That's been a good place for them to go tonight. Running and catching, game of two here. Chris Sims and Major Applewhite, you can compare through 9 starts. Both were 7-2, but when you get beyond that, all the numbers favored Applewhite.
Yeah, they do, especially the passing yardage, 266 per. And there's an important number right there. The touchdown to interception ratio, 10 touchdowns, 11 interceptions for Sims. Sims is throwing the deep ball beautifully tonight, though.
So one of each tonight, one score, one pick. Robertson to throw back. They've got a wall set up, too, for Grover Thompson, the tight end. And he's still going with the flag down to the 1-yard line. It's 44 yards if the play stands. There's a flag about halfway through that 44.
The play will stand in terms of it being plus yardage, but it won't go all the way to the end zone. It was a late penalty on Houston.
Great call, though. They get big 275-pound tight end, 4 blockers in front.
Hey, Dana Dimmel says, we've got some athletes. He says, you just look at our squad. We can line up with people. We've got to figure out where to put them and give them some discipline, recruit some more of them. And I believe him.
They get Houston for a hold. And so.
Well, that was set up well, though, wasn't it?
Holding offense during the run. 10 yards from the spot of the foul.
That erases.
First down, Houston.
That erases what, Dave? 28 yards or so? But it's not from the line of scrimmage. It's from the spot.
And the best call maybe by either coach tonight.
Yeah.
Because.
Well, that was set up.
It completely baffled the defense.
Has to be right there at the top of the screen. A hold.
Well, you know what? Maybe the best call by the officials all night, too.
That was a good call.
44 without that. So they settle for the 31 of the Longhorns and run a little option. Reynolds takes the pitch and knocked out of bounds at the 27 by D.D. Lewis.
Houston's going to sprinkle in a little option tonight. They're going to say, Texas, if you're going to line up man-to-man on us, we're going to fly our guys out of there, and we're going to run some option at you. Good job, though, by Texas. You'd think Texas would be a very good option team defensively because they can run.
This Dimmel package, polished at Wyoming, program he inherited when Joe Taylor went to Purdue, features some option, but some of this four wide outlook, too. Reynolds breaking one tackle. That's one of his best runs, and he settles for 2 yards, and he carries Tyrone Jones for both of them.
I am really impressed with Reynolds. He does not stop after that first lick. He runs both with power and with speed.
And they expected to really split tailback between Reynolds, Leif Penn, who we've only seen a couple times, and Chris Robertson, the Texas transfer. He's only carried it one time. Reynolds has been too hot to take out.
Come back with the screen.
It's worked before.
Man-to-man on top.
Texas coming with a blitz, picked up nicely, and again they miss the connection to Iglesias.
They can't win this game without that connection hooking up. Jammer's great. I mean, Jammer was on the spot, but there have been 3 or 4 opportunities for Robertson to hook up with Iglesias, and most have been on third down situations.
Only one catch for 5 yards. For Orlando Iglesias, who keeps his streak alive, 34 consecutive games with a catch, but too many near misses. Going for it, 4th and 6. Against Rice, they went for it 5 times, made 4 fourth down conversions. This is Leif Penn, and they knock him out at the 18-yard line.
Dana Dimmel. He has it rolling right now. He is just dialed in. He has this Texas defense back on its heels. It's not a big crowd, but it's a vociferous crowd. They are really into this.
It's as big as they can get it here. And they are vociferous.
That's right.
Dana Dimmel calls the plays, and he's got 2 offensive coordinators. So they've got a nice mixture of the minds going. Dave Warner, Chancy Barone. Up in the press box, and Dimmel down on the field. Penn pulled back from the 16 by Rawls. Another Arizona Vegas update. Reese Davis.
And Davis, Vegas creating a little offense with its defense. Arizona running a little option. Jason Johnson pitched not too bad, but Clarence Farmer can't handle it. Ahmad Briggs can handle it. 30 yards to the house, and the Rebels have locked things up at 7 in the first quarter.
2nd down and 8 coming up with 3.5 minutes in the first half. A surprisingly close game. Texas coming in. Nearly a 5-touchdown pick by many experts, but it's 10-7 and Houston driving. They will call their first timeout with 3:19. We'll see if the hot hand of Dana Dimmel stays hot in a 3-point game. We're late in the first half in a 10-7 game, and Houston driving again, even though they've gotten really mostly frustration every time they've tried to go to their top receiver, who's not even on the field on this 2nd down and 8. Movement, but again, Robertson has the presence of mind to throw it before he hears whistles. Dimmel says touchdown, there were whistles this time.
One of these times it's going to go against Houston. Texas has gotten them all.
Encroachment. Defense. Yep. 5 yards. Still remains 2nd down.
Texas really sloppy now, Dave. Now, it's really important for Houston to punch this one in. You want to have the lead. You want to have the momentum at halftime. Of course, Texas gets the ball back, and easily they can go score. But you want that to happen, and you also remember that your field goal attempt a few minutes ago was blocked.
So a second and three. After the third Texas penalty. Robertson making sure everybody can hear him, and now running out of time. One on the play clock, gets it off and throws to the corner of the end zone, incomplete, intended for Brandon Middleton.
That's Babers all over Middleton. 21 white and flat out play. Watch Babers on this one. No chance. That's the way you play it. Middleton, that ball had been thrown on the money. He had no chance. You know, Babers would be considered a superstar if he didn't play in the same defensive backfield with Jammer.
I was just going to say, we call his name more because teams are afraid sometimes to go to Jammer. They don't get much better luck against Babers.
Big play.
They come after him, third and three, and complete inside the five to Ethan Ross. What a huge catch, and he hangs on after a big hit. First and goal, Houston.
Right over the middle, it is open, but you have to hold on to it. You know you're going to get hit. That is just a terrific snag by Ethan Ross. Just knows he's going to get hammered.
The Dixie College connection, Robertson and Ross, set him up at the 4-yard line. Houston trying to take the lead. Won't happen here. Penn does well to maybe get back to the line of scrimmage. And the story, I think, this first half is that Dana Dimmel has found a running game. After 7 rushing yards in their opener, they're running it. That play notwithstanding, pretty much as they need to.
Yeah, they said they were going to become a running team this year. 1-2 tight ends, 2 backs. Last game, though, they chunked it. Was it 53, I believe?
Right, they've outrushed the Horns, 67-65. Another option. And the late pitch, Reynolds to the 3. That's it. Texas recognizes and reacts pretty quickly.
He was trying to pitch that one, though. These options are designed for Robertson to get it out of his hands. He is a good baseball player. He's a good quarterback, but he is no sprinter. Nice job, though, of gaining positive yards there on a play where he actually should have run it.
Now you got to look for him to come through the air on third and goal at the 3.
Well, I'm saying they stay away from up top. You just haven't had any luck up here. You've got Jammer and Iglesias. Go somewhere else.
They come after him over the middle, batted and caught. Touchdown. Grover Thompson with a deflected touchdown for the Cougars. Man that caught one pass all of last year catches the 2 big ones on this drive. And something very few thought they would ever see tonight, Houston with the upper hand on 6th-ranked Texas. 14-10 with Patterson's extra point. And a minute 19 in the first half. Houston tonight has been lucky and good, and they were both on this touchdown because Kalen Thornton gets a big piece of this pass.
You named it. Texas is in great position. They should have intercepted the ball, could have intercepted it. Great job up front by Thornton. And it's early, but Dana Dimmel has it going his way. We sat in his office yesterday, and he was telling us that, you know, I think we have a chance in this. We've got to do this. We've got to do that. And I think you and I kind of looked at each other, and we walked out and we said, I don't know if he really knows what he's talking about. He did.
Well, every coach, it better be optimistic. And he was extremely optimistic, and we're seeing why. He thought they had better athletes than they've been given credit for. They're the consensus 8th pick in the Conference USA preseason standings. Not even respect really within their own conference. But what he said was, if we get an early break, keep it close for a while, make Sims make good decisions all day, that's our shot at shocking the country. This is Hill. a bad return. Texas with a minute 13 starts from their 40, and we check in the studio.
Well, David, Dana Dimel's crew can, in fact, shock the nation. It'll only be the second one of the day. The Tar Heels have already applied the full boot to the backside of the Seminoles. The Cavalier attitude goes down to the very final second. And in the wild, wild west, the Ducks and Trojans fight before the game. We'll get you up to date on USC and Oregon at the half.
Injured Cougar on that kickoff coverage play. And they're looking at Jesse Sowells, a junior from here in Houston, the defensive back.
They kick off an example of what Vasher does for you. Houston squibs it. They're afraid of the big run back. Texas takes it over with a short field, and with the 1:13 remaining, plenty of time.
Pretty remarkable first half by Kelly Robertson. 129 yards, two touchdowns on 8 out of 15. Sims is 8 out of 18. 150 yards, 92 of that on his touchdown to Johnson. And the interception that set up that go-ahead drive for Houston. Let's go down to Holly Rowe.
Guys, fatigue playing into this game right now. The University of Texas players are exhausted. It's one thing to have a big layoff. None of these guys seem to be in game shape. Mack Brown called an early timeout in that second quarter designed to give them a rest, but it seemed like on that last series they gave up a lot of yardage because they were just dead dog tired.
Well, defense has been out there a while. Sims, plenty of time and two timeouts, and that one almost intercepted, and it's Lee Ingersoll fooling Sims by dropping back into coverage from defensive end.
Sims is confused. This is a really important time for Chris Sims. He has time. He's looking deep, comes back. And that ball was thrown right in the hands of Ingersoll. I have no idea what Chris Sims saw there.
He only saw one thing, too. He never looked anywhere else. Ingersoll not used to having a shot at an interception. This one also thrown less than accurately behind Sloan Thomas. And again, you got Ingersoll dropping back. Isn't that interesting? On a wideout.
Yeah, Ingersoll is the best down lineman. They run some zone blitz, and that time he dropped into coverage, but this is a very important time for Chris Sims. Now, they want Sims to play. He's their number one quarterback, but on the sideline, you have a Big 12 player of the year, Major Applewhite.
He has missed his last four. Now 8 out of 20. 1 minute to go in the half. All day. Picks out a good one this time, and Tony Jeffrey has it at the Houston 40.
Now, that's what Chris Sims does. You know, he disappoints you one play, disappoints you another, hangs in the pocket. And that was a beautiful pass. As he can throw balls, Major White, Major Applewhite can't throw. And there's an example of one there. Now, Major Applewhite may get that ball in there, but Chris Sims will get it in there with terrific velocity.
Clock rolling under 50 seconds. Sims can run it for pretty good yardage. Instead, pulls up, and Roy Williams stays in bounds. And to the 26, he gets 14. They'll move the chains and call their second timeout with 40 seconds.
Two-minute drill. Texas and Phil Sims operating very well now.
Well, we get back to Monday Night Football in a couple of days. ABC Sports has a good one from Lambeau Field. Brett Favre and the Packers against the Washington Redskins. Monday Night Football, 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific on ABC.
You know, one of the things that they feel that Chris Sims should, one of the reasons they feel he should play better is that he's the guy. He's not going in for one or two series and Major Applewhite coming in for one or two series. It's his job. But still, there's pressure, Dave. I mean, you can feel it.
They went away from playing them both because they felt last year, Sims especially thought, that it led to him forcing things when he said, well, I may only have a series. I got to make something happen right now. He does not have that pressure. Applewhite, at this point, will only play as any backup would play, not a job share program at all. But with those numbers, top passer in the history of Texas football, I don't know. Would it still be in the back of Mac Brown's mind if Sims continues to struggle in the second half?
We'll see.
Major Applewhite is a great young man, but I'm telling you, that would have to be tough.
Here's their five wide out, empty backfield. And they lock one up for Williams, makes the adjustment, but doesn't make the catch. And that has hurt Sims in each of these first three games. His receivers have not helped him out much. Way too many drops.
Well, that was a great job by Milligan. This ball should have been completed. Roy Williams gets his head back. Milligan doesn't. Williams has it, punches it out. That's great football right there. Good throw, great catch, great knockout.
That's seven pass deflections by Houston defenders tonight. Five wide again, second down. Only a three-man rush. Sims still rolling, decides to keep and get out of bounds at 15. And there is the flag for the lead here.
Houston has made some dumb mistakes like that. And those are the penalties that last year killed them that Dana Dimmel said we can't do this year.
Jason Parker. Not had a good first half. Beaten for the 92-yard touchdown and a senseless penalty here. He can do nothing to affect this play positively. With Sims running out of bounds, all he can do is cost this team 15 yards.
After the play was ruled dead, personal foul, defense, half the distance to the goal, first down.
10 in this case, they move it to the 10. Yeah, it's one thing to hit Sims, it's another thing to go after our guys down there. Now that's over the line.
All right, what'll change here is that Houston won't be in a defense where you have three rush, eight drop. It's a little different now with a compressed field.
They come after him, and he is blindsided. Lost it. It's quickly recovered, though, for Texas by Mike Williams. But Jason Parker gets a clean shot at Sims this time.
Well, they gave him a chance for some redemption, didn't they?
Blindside comes. Chris Sims either doesn't recognize it or the back doesn't have it. I think that's someone that's unaccounted for that you just have to be aware of on the backside. Texas lucky there to maintain possession.
Mike Williams alertly jumping right on the fumble. And now Parker finally with something to crow about. Texas using its last timeout with 15 seconds. And still looking at goal to go, but now it'll be snapped from the 17-yard line.
Well, you got to think with Roy Williams, you'll run a fade route. And they just jump balls. They've had jump balls all night long. Texas hasn't won as many as they typically do or should have done in this game. They've been in position several times, but Roy Williams is a, 6'5 athlete.
Let's go down to Holly.
Guys, this is a tough place right now for Houston. They keep turning to their crowd to get them to make some noise. Every time they turn to look, it's a sea of orange jerseys. They're imploring the few people who are here for Houston to at least make some noise and help them out on this stand.
Holly, I think your initial judgment was right. I'm going to say this is about 65-35 orange over red in Robertson Stadium tonight. And it could be more than that. There's some hard feelings between the athletic departments because 4,000 Texas ticket holders were forced to take refunds because a late decision by the Houston president condemned, basically, some extra stands they put up in the end zone. So those 4,000 Texas fans would have made it even a stronger orange presence.
No timeout. No timeout. You've got to get the ball out of your hands.
And again, Sims steps up with time to the corner of the end zone, and Jeffrey hangs on this time. Touchdown.
Wow.
Flag down after the play, but they already signal touchdown.
Roughing quarterback, defense, touchdown.
And the pass stands from Sims to Jeffrey, and he gets a huge orange crowd up now.
How does that feel for Chris Sims? I mean, I think he's on the ropes, Dave. He's back there throwing balls that could be gone for interceptions, confused. And then he hangs in there on a third down route, moves the chains, makes the right decisions. That was a big-time throw right there.
So close to hitting a lot of deep balls, one that Jeffrey had for an instant in the end zone and couldn't hang on to in the first quarter. And it brings this one in with 8 seconds to spare for the extra point. Rusty Mangum makes it 17-14.
Absolutely perfect. Sims hangs in, cheap shot, another mistake. Yeah, Ingersoll's their best down lineman. Act of frustration there. And you know what? He had thrown that. Ingersoll may have hit him before the ball had even been completed, Dave. But regardless, that was a big-time throw right there from a guy who can make all the throws.
I think you're right. The crowd had to tell him the result of that one.
And those feel all the better.
A road game only on the schedule. Otherwise, it's got to feel like Memorial Stadium at this point for Chris Sims and the Texas team that fell behind ever so briefly, 14-10. He brought them right back. And to 17-14. So completely different feel now. Houston had a chance to go into halftime with a huge amount of momentum behind that.
I think what we just saw there was Chris Sims. We've seen his career in one series. We saw a bad play, saw an incompletion. Then you see a guy hang in there and make plays that only big-time quarterbacks can make.
And you see why Mack Brown and his staff has him out there. They love Major Applewhite. They say no one could have a better attitude than Applewhite has shown, despite twice losing his job as the most productive passer in history. But they see Sims make plays that only a handful of college quarterbacks can even think about
making. No, you're right. The word upside always comes up in conversations. Squid kick to in the half. It's what Texas is looking for.
And it is loose.
Texas gets it.
And Texas has one more shot at him with 4 seconds. Great squid kick by Dan Smith. Chad Davis had a chance to recover it in midair for Houston, and he couldn't do it, and looks like Brett Robin does for the Horns.
This isn't an onside kick. This is a squib kick. Houston does a sloppy job of getting on that football. I believe that was Robin that got on it.
It was, and now Texas will try the leg of Mangum from 47 yards. This is a freshman walk-on who has not missed a kick yet. He's 6 of 6, has hit from as long as 51 yards, twice from 49 or longer. This will be 47, not much angle. And a bolt, Trahan's hold, a low line drive, and he is still perfect. Chris Sims, less than 50%. But the big number, 201 yards and 2 Texas touchdowns. And Texas manages 10 points in the last 8 seconds of the first half. Houston led briefly. They couldn't hang on to it. And it's 20-14 Longhorns, a heavy favorite at the half. Let's send it to Reese in the studio.
Hi, Dave. Something tells me the Cougars rattled that cage one too many times. This is USC in Oregon. Ontario Smith as Mike Vellotti goes deep in the playbook to Justin Peel. Ontario Smith to Peel for the first score of the game, and the Ducks on top of the Trojans 7-0. I mentioned during the first half, before the game, about 45 minutes before, a few of the Duck and Trojan players got together and had a little scuffle led by Rashad Bowman and Antoine Simmons.
No camaraderie there. They should have saved that energy for the field of play.
We got a little energy showing late in the first quarter from the Duck offense. Coming up on the College Game Day halftime report, Ronald Curry jumping up and down. For good reason, Joe Paterno jumping up and down. For a bad reason, we sort it all out when we come back. Welcome back to the College Game Day Halftime Report. Texas on top of Houston, 20-14 at the half. Now, we can quote statistics all day long to tell you how bad North Carolina's offense has been, but this one crystallizes it. Julius Peppers was tied for the team lead in scoring. That's fine if you're Matt Doherty. It's not good if you're John Bunting. Taking on Florida State, they'd never beaten Florida State. Florida State 71-2 in ACC play, so no chance. Or maybe some chance. Darian Durant to Sam Aiken.
Sam Aiken just flies over the defender. He comes on a drag pattern across the field of play. Watch him leap over the defender into the end zone for the score.
Now, John Bunting went with both Durant and Ronald Curry. Here's Durant again, and here is a wide open Chelsea board.
Where's the coverage from Florida State? Down the field to play, you've got to have someone back there, a safety, a quarterback, but there's no one.
Of course, North Carolina could have Julius Peppers back, dropping into coverage, picking off Chris Ricks, who had a very difficult day. It led to a North Carolina field goal. Now it's 20-9. Curry's in there now, and Corey Bailey. This is what's known in the trade as a blown coverage.
It definitely is, because the defense of Florida State, they overplayed the run and did not play the pass. And as you see, Ronald Curry throws the ball down the field to play for another wide-open touchdown for the North Carolina Tar Heels.
41-9, the final. First time Carolina's ever beaten a top five team. And only the third time since Florida State joined the ACC in 1992 that they've lost an ACC game.
But most impressively about this game, 37 total yards that the North Carolina Tar Heel defense gave up in the second half to Florida State. That's never happened to a Bobby Bowden football team.
They held them to 11 first downs. Amazing that the North Carolina defense was able to shut them down like that. So Papa Bowden went down, and the younger Bowden, Tommy, had a difficult game with Virginia. This one in Clemson, Tyree Foreman. And a halfback pass by Billy McMullen. This is in the final minute of the game. It's 24-20. A few ticks to go. Foreman on the carry. Kevin Johnson coming up with a huge stick for Bowden and his defense. The seconds are ticking away. We're going to have to get lined up. We're going to have to run this play. Look at the clock running down. The Cavaliers seem cool, composed. They even seem to be lollygagging. Grohl. I guess he thinks he's got plenty of time.
No pressure, no pressure at all.
But he's running out of time until Bryson Spinner to Billy McMullen. Touchdown, but didn't push off.
But Billy McMullen, here's the push right there. There is a little push off on the play. No penalty called. And Al Groh gets a big win for the Cavaliers.
Al Groh would tell you it's not a push off if they didn't call it. And it looked to be reasonable. It looked like both guys were kind of locked up there. 26-24. Virginia wins this game very much like the way Clemson lost his first game last year when Kerry Watkins caught a touchdown pass for Georgia Tech with seven ticks to go. Maryland and Wake Forest. Maryland undefeated 3-0. Bruce Perry with 276 yards on the ground.
Incredible. He's got over 500 yards, 525 yards in just three games. And he replaced Lamont Jordan, the all-time rusher from that.
And the Terps will make up that game against West Virginia coming up next weekend. In the Big Ten, Joe Paterno going for 323 against Wisconsin, trying to tie Bear Bryant. Anthony Davis, it looks as if Barry Alvarez has found himself a tailback.
Too much team speed. It seems Barry Alvarez is able to replace tailbacks all the time. Here he takes the ball inside, goes to the outside, but has too much speed for the Penn State defenders to tackle before the first down. Here he goes to the left, where he does the same thing. He fights through defenders, but tremendous blocking by his offensive line. Another first down.
And the Badgers also get Brooks Bollinger back. Not that Jim Sorte didn't do a fine job, and he's a better passer, but Bollinger gives him a little mobility here, finding Markinelli.
And it's bad enough when you've got a running back that rushes over to him, then you get a quarterback that throws it over 100 yards rushing, and here Bollinger goes in for the touchdown. It's over 300 yards rushing between quarterback and running back.
Two-point conversion was no good. It was an 18-6 game, and Joe Paterno will have to wait another day. Wisconsin dominated this game on the ground. They didn't even have to punt.
And the thing about it is Joe Paterno said that he was deep at the defensive line position, too deep. They didn't show it in this game. They were just pushed around by the Wisconsin Badgers.
Big Ten has struggled against ranked non-conference opponents coming into this game. And Ohio State taking on one of those foes against UCLA out at the Rose Bowl. Scoreless game in the first. Corey Pause, who's been completing less than 50%. He's had some big plays in the passing game, finding Ryan Smith there at 7-0. Buckeye special teams coming up large. Mike Doss, the fine safety, blocks at Ricky Bryant for the touchdown. PAT was no good, but this game was dominated by the UCLA defense. They hounded Steve Belisari. Only 5 of 23, had less than 20 yards rushing, 13-6. UCLA wins it over Ohio State. Arizona State and Stanford in the Pac-10. Jerry Newberry here. Randy Cassani at quarterback for the Cardinal. And from the 20, Newberry is going to take it to the house. Early on, these two teams, maybe the winner emerges as a dark horse in the Pac-10. They've been running up and down the field still in the first quarter, and that game is now 20-10. I think Arizona State has just added a field goal seconds ago, so it's 20-10. Dirk Cutter making his Pac-10 game debut for Arizona State. UNLV and Arizona. This is Jason Johnson firing down the middle. The Rugo 12 yards. The tight end, John McCormick, loves to get that tight end involved in the offense, and he's been able to do so. Vegas scored by picking up a fumble and running it back. Johnson with good numbers. That's 14-7 there in the second quarter. Washington takes care of Idaho 53-3.
With Washington, they're not afraid to pile up the points. This is a team that really wants to impress everybody across the country. I mean, if you look how well-balanced they are, even though they have a young quarterback, I think this team's going to take great strides in the Pac-10 this year.
Cody Pickett having a nice day in total offense as he continues to mature. Michigan State against Notre Dame. Spartans going for 5 in a row against the Irish. Ryan Van Dyke finds Chris Baker in the end zone. Spartans up 10-3. Van Dyke now the score tied 10-10. This is Charlie Rogers, a fabulous receiver that they get eligible this year, and he's showing some immense talent here.
That's right over the middle, and he uses his speed, and Notre Dame just takes 4 angles on the play. They can't catch
him. What about this fake field goal late with the Irish down by 7?
Huge mistake by head coach Bob Davis. If you're going to run a fake, get up to the line of scrimmage. Just run the play or run the field goal attempt. Don't run a field goal fake.
5 in a row now, 17-10, the final. State wins at Western Michigan in Ann Arbor for the first time in over half a century. Third quarter, 24-7. Wolverines are up. Second and 11. John Navarre, B.J. Askew, who had a big day, over 100 yards, scored 3 touchdowns. Michigan rolls 38-21. The final in that one. Take a look at some more scores from the Big Ten this afternoon. Indiana let one slip away. Utah winning that one 28-26, and Purdue found a little offense.
And you look at the Big Ten right now, and they're out of conference, ranked opponents. They're 1-5 if you throw in Fresno State, and that's not very impressive. They may be the weak conference this year.
With all of the tragedy that we've had to deal with over the last week and a half or so, certainly it has become foremost in our minds what many people are going to sacrifice for our country. Certainly on the minds of those at the Naval Academy. Football is a great pursuit for those kids at the Naval Academy, but they are soldiers first. But today, the job was to take on Boston College. Navy comes out quickly. Brian Madden to Jeff Gaddy. They're inspired. And Mark, you've mentioned before, when you play a service academy team, they never quit.
They don't. That's one thing I always respected about Army, Navy, Air Force. You can have them down 40 points in the fourth quarter, and they never stop. They keep coming at you.
Well, Navy had a lead at one point. Now it's tied at 7 until William Green unties.
And William Green, one of the best backs in the country, 200 yards in his first game, and he's close to 500 yards for 3 games this year. At the end of the season, don't be surprised if his name's mentioned for the Heisman Trophy.
BC coach Tom O'Brien, who graduated from the Naval Academy 30 years ago, goes back to Annapolis. He wins it 38-21. The Army went on the road to UAB, and they fell 55-3. Big day for Jeff Aaron, Watson Browns Blazers. Of course, you're enjoying Watson's brother Mac and his team taking on Houston, and now a game going on here on ESPN2. And Mac's team up 20-14 on the Cougars at the break. We're back to talk a little Big 12. Welcome back to the College Game Day halftime report. We push forward with the story on the field in college football. Fresno State and David Carr taking on Tulsa. And Carr to Marque Davis. Boy, he just throws a beautiful ball. 27 yards for the touchdown. It's a 7-3 Fresno lead in the second when Bernard Berrien makes a nice play.
And you've got to be feeling if you're Bernard Berrien. He gets smacked by 2 defenders, and a 3rd one tries to slap it up, but he still makes the touchdown play.
See if Bernard can get in the end zone a little easier this time. It's a 24-3 game. Carr finds it, and he will break a tackle, though not a painful one. 37-18, Carr goes over 300 yards passing. Once again, some scores from around the Big 12. Kansas State, they get over 100 yards rushing from Josh Scobie. L. Roberson, who only threw for 26 yards against SC last week, threw for 181 on 7 completions. They drill New Mexico State. The Wildcats have Oklahoma coming up next week. And you check some other scores. Baylor, an overtime winner over New Mexico, and Texas Tech is rolling against North Texas. So, guys, as we look at the Big 12 right now, and the team is supposed to be one of the favorites in Texas and struggled a little bit in the first half before a furious finish against Houston there at the end of the first half to take a 6-point lead. Texas will probably be defined by its game coming up in 2 weeks against Oklahoma. Your impressions at the moment of how they stack up?
Well, right now, if you look at the Big 12, you've got to like Texas the way that I liked them since day one. They're not very impressive thus far in this game, but when they really turn it on, they know how to put points on the scoreboard. But if you look at the Big 12 at this point, Nebraska 4-0. Oklahoma is right now lying back, resting, looking for their opponent 2 weeks from now, which is Texas at Texas, which will be a huge game. But I don't think there's a team in the Big 12 that can stand toe-to-toe with the Oklahoma defense and put points on the board. I still believe that they're probably the best team in the Big 12, albeit I like Texas. I think they're going to get better and better. But that game is the showdown game for the Texas Longhorns against Oklahoma at home in 2 weeks.
There are a lot of guys on this list that Chris Sims is keeping of guys who have slighted him. Mark's not on it.
I'm still on that horse. I'm going to stay on that horse until they lose the ball game.
He is not on it, and the Oklahoma defense will have to think about this. B.J. Johnson went 92 yards, fourth longest pass play in Texas history. Virginia Tech hasn't allowed a point in 11 straight quarters. They blow out Rutgers 50-0 in the SEC. Florida gets over 300 yards passing from Rex Grossman again. They've now beaten Kentucky 15 straight times. Alabama, 31-10 win over Arkansas. A couple of defensive touchdowns for the Crimson Tide in that game. Auburn taking on Syracuse. That game just about to end over on ESPN. And Syracuse has gotten a huge game from James Mungro. It's 31-14, and Vanderbilt escaped Richmond. We're back after this.
Same one.
We are the proud and privileged guardians of a rare and priceless book called the Gutenberg Bible. And a longhorn named Bevo. Amen. We're Texas.
The Pac-10, Oregon and USC, that's a 7-3 game at the half. Oregon cornerback A.K. Keys was hit by a teammate on a play, had to be strapped to a cart and taken off the field. He was able to lift his arm, signify to his teammates in the crowd he was conscious and able to move. Certainly, that is good news.
In Oregon, it's supposed to be a dominant team this year, Reese. They just haven't been dominant on the field of play, even though they're 2-0 going into this game.
Arizona's up by 10 on Vegas as they play in the second quarter. We'll keep you up to date on all those games going on in the Pac-10 on the College Game Day scoreboard. That's midnight Eastern time on ESPN.
Back in Houston, set for the second half. Texas 20, Houston 14. A very interesting first half. It looked like Houston would have all the momentum going in. They had taken a 14-10 lead, and in a matter of 8 seconds, Texas gets half their production on a touchdown pass, long field goal.
Can't let down your guard. I mean, Texas is so talented. You do that, and all of a sudden, they're back in the game. I mean, they have guys who can make plays. That's what college football is all about. Chris Sims came back. I mean, I think that he was on the ropes. I don't know that they would have brought Major Applewhite in, but he was on the ropes, Dave, and he comes back with some very, very big plays on that last drive.
Big plays for both teams really characterized the first half, and the biggest was the first 92-yarder. Texas's longest pass since last year. 96 yards, Applewhite to Roy Williams against Oklahoma State in that one. But then Sims' big mistake, Stanford route with the interception, leading to a deflected touchdown catch by Grover Thompson, Houston tight end. He'd come right back, though, with 8 seconds to go in the half. Find Tony Jeffrey in the corner of the end zone, 17 yards. Houston would fumble the squib kick and give Dusty Mangum just enough time to hit a 47-yarder at the gun. So add up the numbers, and Texas totals 265 yards. Over a third of that on one play, 201 through the air for Sims, although he was under 50% at 8 of 15 for 129 and 2 touchdowns for Robertson.
Good third down percentage, 6 of 9.
Well, the squib worked last time they tried it. Why not go with it again? And this time the Cougars hang on. And Tillman returns it near the 35.
Well, he goes straight up the gut. You like that as a coach. Go north and south. We'll see what Texas does defensively. This will be a very interesting series because Houston has had some luck running the football. Texas, the gut of that defense, the tackles that were suspect coming in, suspect in people outside the Texas coaching staff. They're very high on the guys in the middle, but that gut was exposed there for a while, Dave.
mostly by Joffrey Reynolds. Had a lot of success between the tackles, 11 carries, 57 yards. And again, Texas moving early and a flag, but they're pointing across the line. They've done that before, and the officials have not called Houston for movement. I think they are here.
Now, false start. Offense, 5 yards. Remain first down.
And let's check in with Holly Rowe.
Well, Mack Brown told the Texas Longhorns at the half, hey, look, they're 200 yards of offense. 100 of those came on just 3 plays. And yes, they did fool us, but they won't in the second half. He also told his team that they need to create more turnovers and play with more intensity. For Dana Dimmel, he told Houston that they've got to have a big drive here on the first series of the second half. He says if we can get one more lead, we can hang on and win this ball game.
Well, they finally get the connection they've looked for all night. Robertson to Iglesias. It's on target, and he hangs on for 15 yards with the hit applied by Babers.
Well, I started to say that this drive is just critical, and Holly says that the head coach felt that as well. So, and Iglesias, the first half, just shut out. You know, he had some balls that were catchable. He has to make plays. Robertson has had it on the money a great deal. So these guys must zero in here in the second half if they want to beat Texas.
Iglesias, third all-time receiver behind only Elmo Wright, the best ever here, in the run-and-shoot era. That's with almost all last year out with an injured ankle. That's incomplete and a flag down as well, intended for Tommy Baldwin, the fullback.
Well, yeah, they're going to call holding, and it was a senseless holding call against Houston. Robertson was well out of the pocket, and the hold came behind the play.
And just since that last Texas drive of the second quarter, and now twice they've been hit here in the third quarter, Dan Dimmel has seen some of the discipline that he's tried to instill. Lower the total number of penalties and start to go the other way.
Sure can't get away with it playing a team that's favored by over 4 touchdowns.
Blitz. 40 yards. Robertson, another flag down, and this one sails over Iglesias.
Tell you what, that's great coverage out there. Iglesias is just, he has no room to breathe. Jammer jams him perfectly.
Back-to-back holding calls on Houston.
Blitz coming. Let's see where the hold is.
Holding. Oh. Up at 10 yards from the line of scrimmage. Remain first down.
I was looking at the wrong monitor. Here it is again. It's a blitz. We'll see where the hold
is. Yeah,
you get your man down. They'll usually call that one.
That's holding. That's Corey Redding getting dragged down. So the drive Dimmel envisioned to start the second half is going backwards. First and 30. Dump pass, Reynolds, who scored by breaking tackles, brought down by Kalen Thornton, first man to hit him this time.
Well, that was a play perfectly suited for that defense. Texas blitzing, but Robertson running away from it, and he had a chance for a big play. Better tackling that time by Texas. That was the problem on that play the first time. And I think the halftime motivational speech by Carl Reese and also Mack Brown got their attention.
Reese's philosophy, recruit as many defensive backs as possible out of high school, and then the ones that grow, you can move to different positions. Linebackers, everybody else you keep in the secondary. Going deep. And it's caught over the shoulder. Iglesias hanging on for dear life. Vasher and knocked loose at the end, but the fumble comes after he's down, and it's 39 yards to Orlando Iglesias.
Iglesias has to make plays like this. Vasher behind him a step. The ball has to be perfectly thrown on that go route.
And it is. And you have a 6'4 receiver, Dave. 6'3 and a half. Against a 5'11 defensive back. Still a 4-inch advantage.
And unheralded, unheard of, Kelly Robertson throws a perfect deep ball. And not for the first time tonight either. 5 years of no football at all, and it's tough to see any rust. Another flag down. Quick hit, Kalen Thornton. Bursting through from right defensive end to get Penn. Well, so far this half, they're all against the Cougars. Legal shift this time. Major standing at the ready. Texas declines his penalty. They'll take the loss and go with second down. Robertson, a catcher at Dixie College. This is actually his fourth school. Briefly, Angelina Junior College, Lufkin, Texas. Western Kentucky for a semester. Dixie College, good hitting catcher. Decided not to ride the minor league buses. And to go back to his first sport football. Penn up the side, but him out at the 30.
That play has worked for Houston several times tonight. And what has to happen is Texas has to make the stick the first time. This is Jammer coming up right there. You've got to have him.
Did it Jammer jam?
No, Jammer didn't jam him that time. He's an excellent tackler. But on that play, the cornerback has to make that tackle most of the time.
Third and five, Houston. Three wideouts to the left for Robertson. Pitch one out. It's complete. And I don't think enough for the first down. He needed the 25, and Kikoa Bell is a yard short. This is going to be fourth and less than one, I think.
You got to go for it. You got to go for it. You got one block in that same area.
Close enough to measure. And yep. Look at about a foot. Houston, you're as good an underdog as they were. You're within six. You're this close.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. No decision at all.
No, no decision. And I'm just wondering if they want to plow it straight ahead into this Texas defense, which will be plugging up the middle. You're going to have D.D. Lewis up in a gap. Or will they have the guts, Dana Dimmel, to run a play fake? Play fake.
Well, a lot of coaches say if we can't make 6 inches, we don't deserve it.
Yeah.
Got it. Ball is loose. Texas forces and recovers a Robertson fumble on a quarterback sneak.
And David looked like he had the yardage. His initial surge looked well past that first down marker, but he didn't protect the football.
Second effort.
You don't need it.
Looks to cost Robertson here. It's buried by Everett Rawls. And nothing but White jumping on the loose ball.
Yep. Critical, critical mistake.
Maurice Gordon, a defensive tackle. This is recovery for Texas. Roy Williams with a blocker out in front. To get him out there, use his one-on-one athletic ability, and it goes for a first down and 11 yards.
Quick little screen out in the flat. Pretty dangerous player. I asked Greg Davis, the offensive coordinator at Texas, who's the best offensive player. He said Roy Williams. He said he's the most dangerous player we have. Greg Davis here with the glasses. Those two guys exactly the opposite. Both good people. On the left, Carl Reese talks and lives with emotion, and Greg over there looking at his head, his glasses on, looking at his stat book.
Sims on the roll, batted down. Third Robinson coming up from strong safety.
Well, he had his man.
He had Bo Scaife. Little bootleg. The only man between Bo Scaife and Sims was that guy, Robinson.
That is the eighth deflection by the Houston defense tonight. Eight passes defensed.
Oh, that's incredible. I asked them about that, and then they didn't really get a clear answer. Sometimes I think that maybe there's a little bit of a windup.
Huge hole right side. Williams cutting it back to the Houston 45. Arizona and John Makovic. Another update from Reese Davis.
All right, Dave, and that Wildcat offensive front against UNLV is going to do the job here. Sometimes ball's on about the 22, and the C's will part for Tremaine Cox. The redshirt freshman is going to take it to the house. 78 yards, and the Wildcats on top of Vegas 24-7.
John Makovic. And producing a high-scoring offense, which he's done everywhere he's been. Sims, it's time to pick up a blitzing Robinson and a strike to Scaife. Bo Scaife is at the 15. The best buddies have a nice thing going tonight. That's 30 yards. Panic Milligan finally runs him down.
Sims can make all the throws. You know, you get frustrated, I'm sure, Texas fans, at the other play, and then you step back. He gets banged, but that ball's on the money. Scaife running a little skinny post. Robinson a step behind, and Chris Sims with the perfect delivery.
Scaife, three catches now, 44 yards. He had one for four in the first two games combined.
Texas has been issued a sideline warning. Sideline warning on Texas.
You don't ever hear that.
You never hear a sideline warning.
Oh, Mac Brown's over there wanting to talk to the official. You get one warning, and then you get a, what is it? It's a 15-yard penalty, I believe.
It's unsportsmanlike if you don't back off.
Yeah.
Wow.
You got to have somebody who's the backup coach.
Get back.
Mac was telling us a couple days ago, he said, I don't really get upset anymore about this and this. I said, what about the sideline? Look at this. You don't think he's into it?
Well, next time they get him for 5 yards, so they've been duly warned. Still first and 10 here.
Mac is a great delegator. He's a very good football coach. He's a great communicator, great recruiter. But he hands this thing off to Greg Davis offensively and Carl Reese defensively, and he says, guys, you do your thing, and I'll step in when I need to.
Well, this season, he had, if he was a politician, you'd say he'd done a great job of energizing his base, because they've got a record number of season tickets sold by a huge margin, and he brings this resume into a season where Texas is picked to finish no worse than in the top 10, and they have not done that since 1983. When he took over, he said a lot of people have the misconception that Texas is a contender every year. They hadn't been a contender since really late in the Fred Akers era. There have been times where they would make an appearance early in the top 10, drop back, and the season usually ended in disappointing fashion, like the last couple did. Hold up now because of a broken chain. I actually saw this one of the earlier games this afternoon.
Yeah,
chains
are
just not as strong as they used to. They got a backup chain, though. They think of everything.
You got the get-back coach, and you got the backup chains working.
But the difference this year is three of the recruiting classes that Brown has brought in will stack up with anybody nationally. There's talent across the board. He says if there's a weakness, it's we're not very experienced at a lot of our most talented spots. So we're getting experience on the fly this year. Another nice game, Evan Williams to the one. Ivan in the first half, a couple of nice gains early. We didn't really see much of him at all in the second quarter. 14 yards this time.
Watch the power here. Ivan Williams, such a different back than the other Texas backs. Runs through the arm, tackles.
11 carries, 71 yards for the sophomore from Cleveland, Texas. The Diesel, first and goal. tight end set from the one. And Williams, all 235 pounds, turned away. No gain.
Gissen Danner, weak side linebacker, 41 on the stop. Good defense here. Gissen Danner right there. Greg Davis telling me the percentages he looks for in the red zone. 80% score, 67% touchdowns. I would say where they are now, they look a little bit more than 67%.
This game, they scored on 36 straight trips in the red zone. Williams left tackle continues that run for the Longhorns. And Matt Brown says, for the 26-14 lead, let's go for two.
Yep, he wants it a two-touchdown difference. That's almost like, is it Richard Nixon, or does he have the horns up? What's he doing? No, it's a two-point call.
So Williams gets the touchdown, his second of the year. Texas...
12 doesn't do them any good.
Yep.
12-point
lead. Might as well get it up to 14. 13 doesn't do a whole lot for you, so they go five wides. Completely spread out the Cougar defense.
But the Cougar defense gets the sins, and it is fumbled, and you can pick that up, return it for two, but they stumble.
But they do foil the two-point conversion. Adrian Lee. Father Ernest played for Texas, rushing in to foil that one. And so Texas settles for 26-14. For the Cedric Benson coming out party, Ivan Williams says that may have to wait. Here's what happened on the last Texas touchdown.
Nothing fancy, just those big old guys up front. And you talk about big guys, they haven't. Got to sense this from the backside, though, Dave.
That's a couple times that Sims has been really belted hard from his blind side. Jason Parker got him in the second quarter. He's still telling all about it. Mangum with this kick. Middleton on the return. And Derek Johnson, Fly's freshman linebacker, with the tackle. Let's get an update on Oregon and USC out west. Reese Davis.
And Dave, you know, the Ducks have that 22-game home field winning streak working. SC took them to triple overtime in their last visit there. Carson Palmer throwing, picked off by Steve Smith. Ducks had an opportunity here after Smith had a terrific return to get it in USC territory. Couldn't cash in on it, though. It's still 7-3.
Well, there is going to be some shaking up of the top 10 with the shocking North Carolina blowout of Florida State. Oregon and USC is still going. Kansas State will look to move up. Actually, everybody below Florida State is eyeing a move up of at least a spot or two.
Well, the Big 12 well represented there. Florida State, the shocker. They were beaten so badly. I think they're all the way out. Kansas State up there. So you have Oklahoma, Nebraska, Texas. 3-4-5 is how that will look. And then you jump Kansas State up. Dave, what, 8 or 9?
8 or 9 at least. This is Bobby Tillman, injured Cougar return man. Helped off. Finally, he didn't return one, and that's the one he gets hurt on.
I remember the Big 12 with a better showing. Maybe it was the Big 8 back. Colorado,
70,
Oklahoma,
71.
Nebraska. That trio, wasn't it?
71, okay. You had Nebraska first, OU second, Colorado third. They have somebody like that this year.
So watch that guy. Pardon me for interrupting you, but I kind of like this player right here.
Let's see, just made the tackle. Very Johnson. Robertson hit as he got it. A job Johnson does. He just called him, and he shows up big, and Brandon Middleton pays the price.
Oh, I hate to say, I told you so. Now, it's just that this guy makes a ton of plays. He followed up the great kickoff tackle with, he smells the football. He has great instincts, and he has unbelievable speed. He's 6'4" and a half, highly recruited player. Texas gets him, and Mack Brown says he has a nasty attitude.
He's a backup. He's the leading tackler through their first two games. That tells you something, but he's right over there again, too. Ball incomplete, intended for Middleton, down to Holly Rowe.
I'm here with the longtime Houston coach, Bill Yeoman, who has been inducted, or will be inducted in December into the College Football Hall of Fame. Coach, you were here at the beginning of this Texas rivalry back in 1968. There have been better years for Houston, haven't there?
Well, those are some good years, and we had some real good kids, had great games, and turned into a pretty good rivalry before it was over.
Well, you had four Southwest Conference championships under your belt, but you're also known as being famous for inventing the single beer, and I understand you keep trying to talk Dana Dimmel into that.
Dana's got his own offense, and he's going to do a real good job, and they're doing a good job, but it was we were awfully fortunate in getting the triple option going before anybody else knew what it was.
You know, it's important that they play this game on campus here at Houston. How does it feel to have this kind of excitement surrounding the program again as they try to build back?
You have to have it. There's just no question about it. Now, what's going to be a whole lot better is if we pull this thing out, you will not believe what will happen to this place. But regardless, it's maybe a long haul. We have to work at it. Dana's doing a real good job. He'll get the kids that can win, and we'll be all right. We're going to be all right.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to meet you. Hey, and thanks for inventing the beer.
Yeah, everybody likes it, even Texas.
Back up to you.
It's still going strong. Flag down. I don't hear any whistles yet.
Yeah, they called that one. Yeah, I think there was contact, Dave.
They went to Brian Robinson.
But Iglesias, great job going downfield. And as the interview was going on, I believe you were able to see the third down conversion. What a critical play. I mean, if Houston were to come back and do something in this game, you'll point back to that play.
Right to the snap. Encroachment by contact. Defense. 5 yards. Remain first down.
Adam Dorn, 96, defensive tackle. So you see the 5-yard mark off, and Dean, you talk about 13 yards on the third down to Iglesias, and couple of times now, Robertson starting to find Orlando Iglesias, who he overthrew regularly in the first half. Fourth Texas penalty. Makes it first and 5. Draw play. And maybe 2 yards falling forward, getting the 2 for Leif Penn. That's some talent right there.
Yeah.
The Heisman winning Ricky Williams, now with the New Orleans Saints, who's driven down I-10 to make this one. And a guy that many predict will win a Heisman before he leaves Austin. Chris Sims, the background.
All right, you sound like Bino and Ron Palas.
I didn't say I predict.
Okay.
I didn't say he's going to win too.
Okay. Well, I'm not saying he won't. I mean, but you know, the hype is incredible. It's incredible. It's sometimes just too much pressure on these guys.
Let him start a full season first, man. Option, 2nd and 3. Guess who? Derrick Johnson chasing down Reynolds. Dean, this is his 3rd college game. He's already their leading tackler. Not yet a starter, but it may not be long.
Yeah, I mean, that's why when he went in, I said, guys, look at number 11. His speed, his instincts, his strength, he will only get better. He has tools like you rarely see in a linebacker.
He rooms with their other prize freshman, Cedric Benson, and Derrick Johnson has made the biggest early impact. Timeout call by Robinson. With the play clock down to 3 on a 3rd and 8. .541 to go in the 3rd quarter. 16 unanswered Texas points. Dimmel's trying to do something about it.
ESPN2's presentation of Primetime College Football is brought to you by Volkswagen. On the road of life, there are passengers and there are drivers. And by Bud Light, for the great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down. Make it a Bud Light.
After timeout, Houston now ready, 3rd and 8. Robertson over the middle, finds Brian Robinson. short of the first down. He got within a yard and got swarmed and driven back.
Something happened. Yeah. I thought that he was held on that play, and he was held. Johnson, again, in the middle of the action, Dave. He was on blitz, almost getting to Robertson, and at the last moment, he was held.
Offense, penalty refused, fourth down.
All right, so just the mere presence of Derek Johnson.
Well, he's made a play. On every play, he's been involved.
Well, what's he going to be like when he's got like 5-6 games under his belt? All right, they will force a punting situation now for Houston. They've got to worry about Nathan Basher.
Coach Royal has a little statement that some guys have it and some don't have it. And when you ask Coach Royal what that means...
Well, we thought, but they come up with a surprise and they go for it. And the option, again, I think, comes up a little bit short. Well, Houston deciding to take chances. Some have worked. Corey Redding, I think, keeps this one from working. That's pretty gutsy, and it is short. Going for it on their own end of the field on fourth down, but they couldn't get it away from Redding.
Yeah, I think it's the right call. I think you have to go for it. You'd be giving the ball back to Texas with a short field, a lot of momentum. And like you said earlier, if you can't make just 6 inches or a yard, you just don't deserve it. That's good defense right there. D.D. Lewis. Now that was Redding. D.D. Lewis was in the backfield. Redding shedding a blocker, going down the line of scrimmage. That's what you have to do against the option, and he played it perfectly.
So Texas takes over only 44 yards away. And again, they start with this swing pass. B.J. Johnson turns it into a big gainer to the 29-yard line. Check in quickly, Reese Davis.
All right, Dave, let's go up to Austin Stadium. 7-6, Ducks and Trojans locked in a battle, and Carson Palmer. Boy, Steve Smith has Carson's number. Second pick of the game, this one's a pick six. Ducks on top, 14-6. They're about to go to the half. Stanford and Arizona State
for the game.
Randy Wells is in motion. Controls. The Cardinal puts up Masani big numbers. Masani finding Dick Sievers. Sievers will get in there. It's 30-13, almost at the half here.
Texas from the 29 of Houston. Kyle Shanahan. Four about five. Tried to break the first tackle. Reinforcements were there. Stanford route and Herd Robinson.
Tell you what. Chris Sims has zeroed in here, Dave. He's making the right reads. He's making the right throws. And not only is he going to the right receiver, he is putting it on the money. The swing pass a moment ago to B.J. Johnson, perfectly in stride. That's why you had such a big pickup. That was a good throw to Shanahan as well.
And he's starting to get big. 4 out of 5, 62 yards in the second half for him. Boy, more impressive power running by Williams. Arthur Gissendaner had to have some help to get the diesel down.
The playbook at Texas might seem really thick, and it is when you work in all the different personnel groupings and formations, but Greg Davis really has 3 or 4 basic runs and 6 or 7 basic throws coming into a game like this. But by the time you get those passes into multiple sets, he probably has 75 throws.
The power group out here. Edwards in motion. Get it to Williams out of the eye, and easily enough for the first.
Houston getting manhandled. I mean, Kirk Hughes, big, strong right guard. Williams, the muscles, and Dimmel knows that the other Williams, 63, Gissendaner, those guys can't hang in there with him. I think you're seeing that the beef, the muscle of Texas just take over, Dave.
That was the fear. Because they knew man for man for 60 minutes, they couldn't stand up to Texas talent if they were able to run the ball and just power up the middle, play after play. They're starting to show that ability. Sims for Skate, his fourth catch
Down to the five, first and goal, Texas. And this has been the coming out party for one of the highly recruited tight ends the last few years, Bo Scaife, finally healthy after two knee operations.
The thing about Chris Sims is that he gets the ball to the receiver so quickly, they have chances for yards after catch. Bo Scaife, that's what happens there. He has a chance to make a move on Milligan. Normally a good tackler, but the intensity not there right now for Houston. Sloppy tackling.
So they want to have a relationship with Scaife like Troy Aikman had with Jay Novacek. One is always there. Down near the goal line. Stopped at the one. Ivan Williams. Reggie Medlock kept him out.
Just sort of see the tent collapsing for Houston. Texas has a lot to do with that. They have a tremendous amount of talent up front. You're going to see guys like Williams, 63, drafted and playing in the NFL. Kirk Hughes, of course, the receivers, those guys with the NFL players. You have a lot of talent in wideout.
Our backfield again, another give. Ivan Williams, another Texas touchdown. Said the first two games we could have lined up every play, five wide receivers, thrown it for 400 yards, scored 60 points, but would we be better for it? No. We're going to have all our goals realized this year. We have to be able to run the football. And so he's dedicated much of these first three games to getting the running game in check. And in this second half, it's starting to look like they have it. Mangum perfect on the PAT, 33-14 Texas. That's 23 unanswered points. And it's 39 straight successful trips inside the red zone. Well, Mac Brown has never been 3-0 at Texas. If you go back the last couple of decades, seldom has Texas ever started 3-0. They've been tripped up early. Looks like we're going to prevent it here. Another Ivan Williams touchdown stretches their lead to 19. And on the return, Brandon Middleton out to the 27.
Point of attack right there. Texas just mashes them. 46. Fullback, you never get the ball. Look at him laying around in the end zone. Anderson, the big guys. Chris Sims knows that his muscle, his team's muscle, has taken over. Speaking of muscle, he has some more muscle. He's one of the, they say he is the hardest worker in the weight room.
It was really striking. Greg Davis said by far he is the hardest worker on this team. It's not even close. And that's one reason that despite all his height, he is very well liked, because he works as hard as any of the guys and blends in very well. Godfrey Reynolds, not the factor he was in the first half.
Yeah, it wasn't as though in the first half that Texas was out of position, Dave. They just didn't play with emotion and intensity. Mack Brown here on the sideline during the commercial, running up and down, exhorting his troops. Lots of energy from Mack here in the second half. I think when this game's over, that's what you're going to hear him say. Sleepwalked first half, woke up in the second.
Also going to watch very intently to see how they finish the job. Having finally built a comfortable lead, does not want to see Houston fall back in the last quarter. Robertson hit as he delivered. Bashir with the pick. No big games in the punt return game tonight for Nathan Bashir, but he comes up with a big one from strong safety and a return of 9 yards.
You know, these safeties are like cornerbacks. Basher is in the right place at the right time. Crossing route in the middle, you get pressure from Rawls. It helps. And that time, Robertson let go of it with someone in his face, and that someone is Rawls right there, number two. So Basher gets it, but I think he owes part of that to his blitzers.
Yeah, an awful lot of it. First interception from Nathan Basher, and again, Texas taking over
great field position. Houston 25. A lot of short out patterns in the third quarter.
Yeah, but Dave, I mean, those are on the money. I mean, that ball, you can't not catch it.
Roy Williams caught it. Right at the 20, gain of 5. Some ways, though, if I'm the secondary, I'm very happy to see Roy Williams catch a 5-yard pass. That means he's not trying to run past your high secondary. Texas is nearing 400 total yards in the quarter still to go. Back to the ground game. Alvin Williams stepping over a tackler and all the way to the 2. Another first and goal. Adrian Lee got him after 18 yards.
What blocking up front for Texas. They are absolutely mashing Houston. Mack has the guys up front, Dave. I mean, he's loaded up with 300-pounders. Williams, 63, is 350.
But they're 300-pounders who can move, making them dangerous. That's 102 yards now for Ivan Williams, 18 carries. Well, they call on him again, and he gets within about a half yard. Two touchdowns and close to his third on what is going to be the last play of the third quarter. They're going to have to move 99 yards for the first half of the fourth quarter. Texas by 6 at the half, and they stretch out the lead to 19. A very effective third quarter. 33-14 for the 6th-ranked Horns at Robertson Stadium.
They've got the juice.
Sold out Robertson Stadium. Most folks are happy. Most folks here wearing orange and white in Texas. And those in red have been a solemn, subdued group through the second half. Second and goal to begin the fourth quarter. A yard out. Texas again with the power set. And this time, play fake wide open. Touchdown, Brock Edwards. Houston thought one more time they're going to see Ivan Williams come slamming off tackle. And instead, sophomore tight end from Fort Worth, Brock Edwards, totally uncovered.
Well, defensively, you can't cover them both in goal line. You've got to go after the quarterback or drop. Stay with that tight end, and it's much more of the time you go after the quarterback.
Dusty Mangum still yet to miss a kick of any type in his freshman season. 40-14 Longhorns. As they fake power and go to the sleight of hand.
Everyone thought, including us, Williams, and that's when it's fun as a quarterback. Look at him.
He's had both guns blazing the second half, hasn't he?
Yeah, he has. He really has. He had just that little bitty part of that second quarter where he was out of sync.
This game really turned with 8 seconds to go in the first half. When Sims found Tony Jeffrey for 17 yards. That made it 17-14. They fumbled the kick, got a long field goal to end the half. And in the second half, Texas has come up with a Robertson fumble and this Basher interception. Two touchdown runs by Ivan Williams. And now with the fake to Williams being effective, they throw for a yard for their latest score.
Yeah, this is when it's no fun for Houston. Texas knows you're going to throw. Carl Reese has that philosophy of 4 doesn't get him, we'll send 5. He says if 5 doesn't get him, we'll send 6. If 6 doesn't get him, we'll send 7. Kelly Robertson's going to see 7 or 8, just whatever it takes to get to him.
Dusty Mangum now taking over the kickoff chores from Dan Smith. And this is Leif Penn. Not much on the return. Bo Trahan, special teams standout. Let's send it down below to Holly Rowe.
Well, I have a very special mom tonight. Mary Redding has some very split loyalties. Her son, Corey, is playing for the University of Texas. Her other son, Chris Redding, is starting for the University of Houston. This has been a pretty stressful day for you so far, hasn't it?
It's been a stressful week. It's really been a stressful week.
But I like how you split it up. You sat on the Houston side for the first half, and then what'd you do at halftime?
At halftime, we switched over, so we get both boys equal time.
Well, I think it's important that you do that, but also more important, tell us about how they were growing up. That had to be a huge rivalry in the house.
No, there was no rivalry. They've always been each other's best friends. They've always been each other's biggest fan. And at this point in our life right now, I think they are going to be the two Twin Towers that stand in the strength of the nation.
Well, I really like what you've done with your T-shirt. You've got some pictures of the boys when they were little. But more importantly, look at the back. Turn around for us, Mary. I like this. Yeah, the burnt orange 40. And we got the 73 in red. This mom knows how to do it. Thanks for being with us, and good luck with your boys.
Thank you.
Back to you, Dave.
Congratulations to her T-shirt manufacturer. Well, that's she can't great. Lose. That's how I look at it.
That's great. We're not going to overdo it. This guy is who we're looking at here, Johnson.
Second down and six. They're going to get holding on Texas, incomplete for Iglesias. Jammer head coverage, and wow, was that ever. That's Chris Redding, who had the flag thrown not only on him, but at him, because Kalen Thornton was being tackled coming from right defensive end.
Well, the good thing is we don't have, it wasn't thrown at him in a dangerous way.
This ball tonight will follow us.
We have offsetting fouls, holding, offense, interference, defense. Those penalties with offset, replay, second down.
Interference on Jammer, offsetting the holding.
And yeah, watch the flag here, Redding.
Oh,
right there. Heads up, heads up.
Yeah, you know, luckily, unlike a couple years ago, that didn't do any damage.
No, that's right.
That wasn't too funny. But it
what was
in the NFL?
No, it wasn't. That one ended up very, very serious.
Second and seven. Houston's having a hard time getting organized, and they've got 4 seconds to get the snap. But they manage. And they are all over Robertson. Big Stevie Lee, redshirt freshman from Shreveport.
What you should do there is call timeout. Total confusion on that play. And Dave, you had it on the play clock. Robertson felt like he had to get the snap. He got the snap all right. His guys weren't ready. From his blind side, Stevie.
Stevie had himself a pretty good high school career. Evangel, Christian, and Shreveport. Never lost a game, won the state championship all 4 years.
Evangel's pumped out a bunch. Brock Berlin.
They're still coming. Third and 14, Robertson. Heaving deep into double coverage. And almost intercepted by Dakari Pearson. All right, we're pretty sure they're going to have to punt this time. In fact, I know they will. Fourth and 14. So Vasher drops back. He's fresh off a record-setting day, 153 yards against North Carolina, and Mack Brown tells you why.
Coach Royal has a little statement that some guys have it and some don't have it. And when you ask Coach Royal what that means, he said, if you've got it, you'll know it. If you don't know what it means, then you don't know it, so you don't have it.
Well, Nathan has it. He showed it over and over against the Tar Heels. Only a couple times he gets a chance to return one tonight. Not bad here. Sets him up at the Houston 40. Brings it back 16 yards. And Texas set up to add to a 40-14 lead. Early in the fourth, Texas 40-14. Carl Ravage, Peter Gammons, every weeknight at 10, and again at midnight Eastern baseball tonight. We'll have an addition immediately following our game. As the pennant races wind down. 12:55 from the Houston 40. Cedric Benson's fourth carry of the game, and you see a little flash of why he was the most decorated player in the history of Texas high school football. 3 years in Midland League, 3 5A state championships, and the state player of the year all 3 years.
Now, this is when you want to go play. There are the numbers on him, but you want to go play when you've got a defense on the run, when you've got the first team offensive line in there, you're going to see some holes, just like the one that came up. You give a young man an opportunity to succeed.
And again, tries the right side. Weaves his way for about another 10. With all the accolades, Mack Brown says after watching him in fall camp, he's better than I expected.
Yeah, he really likes him. I was at practice on Thursday down in Austin, standing with Mack and watching Benson, and he just kind of shook his head. He says he's got it, you know, speaking of it. But he likes his hands. He says he's learning blitz pickup. He says his balance, vision, all those things is what you want. Some coaches would say the real deal. This guy's special.
Got to meet his hero finally tonight, Ricky Williams. That made him want to become a Texas Longhorn. This is going to be close. Robin Tremblay, senior from Quebec City, Canada. Ricky's sticking it out, too, after making an appearance just a half hour or so before kickoff.
You know,
he's
Dave,
staying for the whole thing.
Pardon me. You know, we've seen some players come from small schools and become great players, but coming from a great program like this really helps him be ready to go in and play ball, to be able to step up to that next level. I mean, it was great competition where he played in high school.
He's played in front of crowds this big.
Yeah, he has.
More than a few times. Third and still one. And Benson knocked out on the ankle tackle by Gissendanner. So he gets him down to second and one, now third and one, and fourth and two after he's cut down for a loss. We'll get Mangum on for a long field goal try.
Well, it was a year ago that Mack Brown was accused of running up the score, was it not, Dave?
And they have not forgotten.
Yeah.
That was an odd game because they started Sims, and after three series and minus 24 total yards, they pulled him. Applewhite came in. They got Sims in at the end of the game, and they wanted to get him some passes, so he was just throwing deep with a 48-0 win. Yeah. Mangum, 36 yards, and he finally proves human. Wide left, his first miss, and it stays 40-14. So Dan Dibble said, you know, we had chances to move this game off campus. I wanted Texas on campus for some payback for that run up last year. Houston from their 20. They've been given up 30 unanswered Texas points. So they go Robertson shotgun and try one deep. Single coverage and incomplete. Babers following Orlando Iglesias every step of the way.
Good coverage in the secondary for the most part tonight for Texas. Iglesias comes in 6'4". You've got wide receivers, Robinson, Middleton, Bell, Iglesias. Those guys can play. And they are big receivers.
Alluded to it a little bit. Dana Dimmel had a chance to move this game to San Antonio's Alamo Dome for $1 million guarantee. Texas, when they signed this contract, figured they'd still play in the Astrodome, get a lot more of their fans in. Dimmel turned down all the big money because he wanted the emotion of the on-campus crowd here. And it carried him for a half. That's dropped by Bell. But in the second half, talent starting to wear them down. And the last six Warren possessions have produced points every time until Mangum finally with the hook field goal on the last one. Four touchdowns and a field goal and 10 points in the last 8 seconds of the first half. Touchdown, fumble kick return, 47-yard Mangum field goal at the gun. They went from down 14-10 to up at the half, 20-14. And Houston has not been able to stop that onslaught at all.
Oh,
going deep and wide open this time. Brandon Middleton, goodbye. Mistake in the coverage. 80 yards later, Houston back on the board.
Well, just as we were complimenting the Texas secondary, Babers was confused. That's what happens when you go deep all night. You catch someone in a bust one time, and it'll go for six.
Flag down in the end zone after the ensuing celebration.
After the touchdown, we have an unsportsmanlike conduct against the scoring team. That'll be a 15-yard penalty.
Brandon Middleton, off a medical redshirt year last year, broke his arm after really showing promise in an 8-catch day against LSU. So a sophomore from here in Houston, with by far his biggest play as a collegian, gets Longhorns back within the Cougars back within 20, and it may be Major Applewhite time when Texas gets this back. First, it's going to be a 35-yard point after attempt.
What better, Jeff Patterson? How bad it is, Major Applewhite time. It'd be a good time to do that.
Well, and it is a costly penalty. Patterson hooks the PAT, and it stays 40-20. We'll see if Chris Sims stays the Texas quarterback when we come back. Houston not giving up. They get an 80-yard touchdown on a mistake in the coverage.
Well, the route goes deep right here. Babers thinks he has help right here. Safety, Pearson is supposed to be over the top, or at least that's what Babers thinks. Not there. So one little mistake in communication results in a touchdown off.
Well, he's had some problems on the kicks. This is the second one that's gone out of bounds, and this one, I mean, not even a real good squib kick. It's not even close to staying inbound. I'm not sure what they were trying to get out of that one. Baseball tonight coming up. We've got 9:48 to go. And we saw Major Applewhite warming up as if he was ready to go in. But Chris Sims is the man in the huddle and again heading back out to the field. Let's send it down to the field, Holly Rowe.
Well, Dave, you are alluding to the fact that more Texas fans wanted to come to this game than could get tickets. One of the reasons, temporary bleachers were set up in the end zone. But the university president, Arthur Smith, took an inspection himself this week. He got up to the top. It felt very unsteady. He said he wouldn't feel comfortable with his daughter or wife sitting there, and so he declared them unusable. Ticket refunds will be issued to fans who had tickets for those. But on the positive side, some people said we won't get refunds. We'd like to donate the money to the relief efforts for September 9th.
Well, something good comes out of it, but I think something else is going to come out of it. Unless DeLoss Dodds cools off somehow, because he is really steamed. That, first of all, they played it in the smaller park, and then 4,000 of their Houston-based fans can't come. That they have one more game in the contract in Austin next year, and I'd be very surprised if Texas wants to renew this series.
Not under the current circumstances.
Benson, after the 12-yard completion to B.J. Johnson, because their thinking is, we play Houston because we've got a huge fan base, lots of alums here in the city, but we don't have to play Houston to play in front of that group. We can play Rice, and Rice plays in 70,000-seat
right.
Rice Stadium.
Right.
And Texas would not have minded if Houston had moved this game to Rice Stadium. Houston's standpoint, on the other hand, they certainly get the right, it goes without saying, to play home games where they want to. I think Texas' big problem is that they didn't check those stands out much earlier than just a few days before the game. Before plans had been made and tickets had been sold. Benson again. Inside the 40, Holly again.
I'm standing by with one of the most famous men in Texas football history, Coach Darrell Royal. It was in this series back in 1968 that you unveiled a very famous offense for the very first time. What was it called?
Oh, you're talking about the wishbone. Emory Ballard was an assistant on our coaching staff that time. He came up with the idea, and we put it in the fall without the benefit of spring practice. So we learned pretty fast how to run it. Our first ball game, we ran against the University of Houston and had a tie ball game. And we got a little bit better as the season went along, ran it a little better.
Did you have any idea it would become so popular and so difficult to stop?
I really didn't. I knew that we had something that was a great ground attack because every play in it was a short yardage play. So you're used to making short yardage all the time, and you have to do that when you're on the goal line. And you have to hammer it in there pretty hard. And all plays of the wishbone were short yardage plays, every one of them.
Well, times have changed, but it's nice to see some teams still using it. Thank you very much, Coach.
Thanks a lot.
Back to you.
It was debuted to the world in this game, 1968. Roy Williams drops it as he's in the middle of a big gator, and the Cougars recover it. Well, you see it all on one play. You see the ability, the potential, and the improvement that is still there to be made.
Well, and you see Darryl Royal leading into that play. So there was a lot within 20 seconds.
Three things can happen when you pass. Two of them are bad, and here's one of them.
Roy Williams was just in full gait there, looking like he was headed to the end zone. Did not secure it.
Reggie Medlock did. And so Houston down 20 points, gets it back. Make it more interesting still, almost 8 minutes to go. At the 68 meeting, Texas tied 2020 with Houston. They lost the next game, Texas Tech, and they won the next 30.
Wow.
Two national titles mixed in there as well. Robertson sack, Kalen Thornton shows why they've been holding him all night.
Texas really likes Thornton. They think he's the secret of that front four. And he was blocked on this, although quickness beats size every time, and I think that is the perfect example of that. Redding defeated by the quick feet of Thornton.
One of a number of Longhorns with pro bloodlines. His dad, Bruce, former Dallas Cowboy. Iglesias secured by Jammer. Gave him the short completion and nothing after the catch. A lot of pennant race action to catch up on. Baseball tonight will follow us immediately. 7 minutes to go for Dimmel. Mets stay hot. Come from nowhere to make that a three-team National League East race. 14 out of their last 16. Show you all about that. Third and 13, Robertson shotgun. And coming on a blitz to knock it out of his hands, D.D. Lewis. Texas gets this recovery.
D.D. Lewis coming on a blitz. And he didn't stop until he got to the football. He's been an active linebacker tonight. He'll come from right up here. Beats the block, stays after it. Nice job by D.D. Lewis. Sometimes you come free. That time he didn't come free. He had to beat a blocker to get around to get to the quarterback.
Major Applewhite with 6:44 to go gets a huge ovation from the Texas fans. They're all still here. A lot of the red, white, and departed.
First plays in. He checks. That to say, he's going to try to come to 12.
It will be a flag. And it will be on Jason Parker for holding Tony Jeffrey.
Major Applewhite is so fun to watch play because you can almost see what he's about to do. He checked into a little stop and go on a one-on-one near Brownie. That was either going to be a touchdown or a penalty.
Defense, half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
He's got a little stop, pump. He's beaten. He knows he's beaten, so he has to hang on. And Jason Parker, the best corner man on the field in red, beaten badly.
All-time leading passer in the history of Texas football, 311 total yards behind James Brown's school record. But behind that man this year as a senior, Benson cutting it back down to three. And yet through it all, Greg Davis says he could not be more pleased with Major Applewhite's attitude and his approach, and it can't be easy when you have all his accomplishments, and he's done it in big games. He's beat Nebraska twice.
And he's healthy. He's feeling good. Greg Davis says, this is a guy who fed my kids for a couple of years. So he's the kind you want to marry your daughter, preacher.
who wants to be a coach. Mac wants to hire him. All those nice things.
Benson or nothing will be third down. Well, part of the maturity of a future coach comes out in Applewhite and says, you know, I got this job because Richard Walton had waited his entire career, finally got his senior year to start, and injured early. Applewhite took over much better than anybody expected as a freshman. And it was injuries that gave Mac Brown the opening to try Chris Sims. A couple of knee injuries and Applewhite sidelined for long stretches of his career. So really the same method that got him his chance has gotten Sims his chance.
Players stay and you'll play. You'll have a chance.
Third and goal from the three. Fires. Touchdown. Bo Scaife.
He's a surgeon. Major Applewhite. Bo Scaife, as soon as he turned, Major Applewhite had the ball on the money. No, he doesn't have the arm of Chris Sims. But he knows where to throw it. He has great anticipation, and he's accurate. And those two guys respect one another. They've always been the first one to congratulate each other.
Applewhite serves up Bo Scaife's first college touchdown catch. And Mangum makes it 47-20 Texas. Applewhite didn't have long to drive it. It didn't take him long either. 5:21 to go.
Question.
47-20, and Major Applewhite may be a little rustier than normal, but doesn't take him long to get right back in the swing.
Well, Bo Scaife is here. Milligan's got to come make that play. He doesn't. He's not close, actually. Major Applewhite zips it in. Easy touchdown. You can't play 5 yards deep in the end zone with a safety. Excuse me, with a tight end releasing.
Megan kicks it high and short to Penn. Short return to the 25. Houston has had happier nights than this in this series, and one of the happiest was one of the early appearances of the run and shoe, but it was the defense that became the story in a 60-40 Houston win. Four interceptions returned for touchdowns. This one by Randy Thornton. The other three all by Johnny Jackson, setting a single game record. And a guy who would become really well known in a couple of years, engineering a Heisman Trophy campaign in 1989 as the run and shoot came to a full flower. Andre Ware. Texas has played 152 games where they scored 40 points. That's the only one they've ever lost. Going deep, and it's caught. Brian Robinson brought down by Jammer. And Houston keeps firing deep, and a few of them hit. This one goes 36 yards.
How many times tonight have we seen receivers just locked in? You see a cornerback or a safety, locked in man with the receiver, going straight down the field, just a go route, and the quarterback and receiver are just playing a game. Jammer that time did not get his head turned back early enough to make that play.
Still have to be so impressed with Kelly Robertson. High school ball in 96, and then starts his first two games 5 years later. Decision making, ability to throw. On the run, and another deflection caught by Houston. They got a touchdown that way in the first half by Grover Thompson. Iglesias gets this one for 22 after Jammer had a hand on it.
There was a lot that happened on this play. Jammer had a chance to pick this one off. Goes off his hands. And then watch the stick here. Beautiful stick by Brooks. Jammer goes from Oski to giving up a long yardage play. He's always in the vicinity, though.
Yeah. Looked like he couldn't quite decide whether to bat it away or catch it, and he didn't either. So, they just keep driving. They run. Ekoa Bell, the end around, all the way down near the 1 yard line, and it's Brooks saving the touchdown. 14 yards. You got Texas starters still out there defensively. Houston moving.
Well, they suckered number 40 right there, Redding. And that's the objective on that play. Get around the end, and Redding closed down too quickly. Bell was able to get around almost in the end zone.
First and goal, ball at the two. Reynolds in the backfield. They give it to him and fake it to Bell, and Reynolds has the touchdown. Joffrey Reynolds with a touchdown catch and now a touchdown run. And Damon Dimmel called it pretty well. He said, we will not quit.
Well, yeah, I was just about to say, this is, they're not going to win, but they could have easily just folded the tent, kicked it back, and let Major Applewhite go to work again, but they didn't do that.
Said, if I can get guys to play as hard as my Wyoming players did,
yeah,
a lot more talent here, a lot better opportunity to recruit talent here, and this program could be what it was under Bill Yeoman. Going for two. And a flag down near the line of scrimmage as Jammer knocks that one down.
How many times have you said Jammer tonight? I mean, he is in the vicinity all the time.
Holding Houston, no two-point conversion. Dimble's done a smart thing that Mac Brown did when he first took over. Brown immediately embraced Darryl Royal.
Right.
Dimble did the same for Hall of Famer Bill Yeoman. Smart move.
This ordinary...
Just under 4 minutes to go. Texas by 21, 47-26. Game was a lot closer than many expected to be. Close for an entire half, and Texas has rolled throughout the second half.
I think you've seen depth come to the fore. I think you've seen the emotion come after the halftime speeches, I'm sure, by Mac and the assistant coaches. And Chris Sims was absolutely on. We were talking about in the second quarter what a struggle and what happens if. Gosh, he's come back. Three touchdowns, over 300 yards.
Houston's Dustin Bell with the onside kick. And it didn't go far enough, so Texas players run away from it. And now a little scuffle ensues after the Cougars decide to pick it up. Houston players telling each other, Texas players telling each other, run away from it. Don't help them out by touching it here. And Jesse Sowells in the middle of it. So that is where Texas will take over at the unsuccessful onside kick.
Well, let me ask you, Dave, this is a similar situation, I guess, to last year when Chris Sims was able to throw a touchdown pass. 3:47 to go. You put in Major Applewhite, who's wanting to play. You got Vincent in there, who's wanting to play. What plays do you call? Do you throw it? Do you let him check into a pass?
I would think mostly they try and get Benson as much experience as you can, and Sims ends up with really nice numbers after a fairly slow start. 311, three touchdowns, 20 out of 35. Robertson, even better, 20 of 32, 364 yards, also three touchdowns and one interception. No hype compared to Heisman hype,
right.
And Robertson can more than match Sims.
Well, and he's another one who was on the ropes, and he came back. What a tough kid. 364 yards. Now, that's going to make some teams on down the schedule think about what they may be able to do. Now, this is a great secondary at Texas, but those are big numbers.
This is the top pass defense in the country a year ago. He's rolled that up on. If the Dimmel system produces numbers like that, it did at Wyoming. You say, who reminds me a lot of my Wyoming quarterbacks? So Texas from the Houston 43. And indeed, they start with a run by Benson. Flag down. After Benson reaches the 36. The whole package, they say. Vision, toughness, balance. Plenty of speed and quickness holding Texas.
Don't you get the feeling that Mac Brown is sitting back there feeling pretty good about the fact that at some point he's going to have Chris Sims getting better and better? They say 75% to 80% of his potential he's playing to right now.
Now
And then you have the wide receivers. The young guys grow up. You know, you have Roy Williams, and you have Sloan Thomas, and you have B.J. Johnson. And then you have the tailback back there. I mean, you've got all the pieces to make it really happen, and they're all young.
And he said, you know, the first two games we won handily, and people are coming up saying, well, you'll get better. Chris Sims said people coming up on campus saying, don't worry, you'll get your stuff together. They're averaging 40 points and, you know, two solid wins. They may be saying some of the same here about the defense. The offense has rolled up 47, but not many expected Houston to get 26 on the Texas defense. So now it's Applewhite for the last 3 minutes. And they've got Texas Tech in Austin next week, and then Oklahoma. You still get a chance to watch Oklahoma right in your backyard. How do you see that one?
Well, Oklahoma has a tough one before they get to that. There you see the numbers first and second half. Texas good, and Houston getting some big numbers in the second half. But Oklahoma has Kansas State to play before that. Kansas State a huge winner today, so a major test. And if Oklahoma were to get past that.
Benson to the secondary. Picks up 13. Texas has the best schedule they could possibly ask for to make a national championship run. Big games at home. They don't play Kansas State. They don't play Nebraska. They would only see either of those two if they reach the Big 12 championship game. So that shows how big Oklahoma is this year. It's Oklahoma. Again one of the biggest games in the country.
Well, it has a chance. If Oklahoma gets past Kansas State, it has a chance to be one of the biggest that it has been in a long, long time. It's been a storied rivalry, but just a huge game. Both teams in the top five at least.
Applewhite. They're waiting for Robin to break free. Pumped it to him, then got it to him, and Robin still going to the 13-yard line. 27 yards.
Well, you talk about savvy. You know, you use that word and you say, well, really, what does that mean? Well, it means Major Applewhite. Here's a play where Major Applewhite could have gotten rid of the ball right here, gotten nervous, gotten happy feet. He holds on to it. His man comes open, Robin on a screen, and turns it into a big play. Just has a feel for the game that's really unusual.
Anik Milligan and Adrian Lee said, we want to see Sims in there, Applewhite on the bench. Well, that's some of what they were referring to. Benson, the short side of the field, and still going, steps over tacklers all the way down near the one. So they're getting the best of both worlds on this drive. They're letting Applewhite throw a little, but they're also getting Cedric Benson some experience.
They had a little tightrope act here. Houston thinking maybe out of bounds, and Benson saying, no, I want to get in that end zone. I think Texas is going to feel really good after this game. Looks like they get out without any injuries. They get tested in the second quarter. Sims gets tested, and then I don't think you could respond any better than they responded, Dave.
Not on this side of the ball. Benson right through for the touchdown. His third as a Longhorn. Texas will get flagged for a celebration. Benson, 14 carries tonight, 74 yards, strictly in a support role behind Ivan Williams, who had 103 yards. And he gets his third college touchdown.
After the score, personal foul against Texas, 15 yards, one play for the point.
You want to call it personal foul, not for celebrating. Benson can celebrate, though.
Man, practice on a field goal.
Yeah, Mangum, who finally missed, 36-yarder, will try a 35-yard PAT. Dana Dimmel will fall to 0-2. But he'll see a few things he can build on, mostly from his offense. Mangum's kick is wide right, so his first missed PAT. Both quarterbacks have had some moments tonight. And Texas, for the first time in 7 years, wins its first three. In keeping with the high-scoring history of this series, these two combined for 79 points. Both offenses well over 400 total yards. 43 seconds still to go. Then returns it to the 22. Texas had given up a few big plays defensively, but they have turned in a few as well.
They have made some ferocious plays, and there's my guy. I take credit for Derek Johnson. You get the rest.
All right, you got Everett Rawls. You got Stevie Lee. You have Galen Thornton.
Where's Dede Lewis?
Right here. Oh. Carson recovering his own fumble. He's showing up as well. Derek Johnson with an unlimited future based on his first three games.
Well,
after the play was ruled dead, personal foul against Houston, half the distance to the goal, first down.
You know, he got more reps in the North Carolina game, and watching him there and just seeing him in practice, it seems like if he can get in position to make plays, he's going to make them. But you get a new guy like that, as immensely talented as he is, if he is out of position by just a little bit, he can't make plays. And once he gets in position, play after play after play, no one's going to stop him.
Not many are stopping him right now. Robertson had Brian Robinson running deep, and he expected him to stop and run a quick out.
The he is this guy right there. Derek Johnson was the fellow we were referring to, and his future is big.
His bloodlines are impressive. His brother Dwight with the Philadelphia Eagles, his cousin played college football here at in Houston at Rice, Bert Emanuel, and then a long NFL career. Game for Waco High against John Tyler has 30 tackles, forced 4 fumbles. Mike Singletary numbers here. Robertson is finally run down, crossing all the way to the 21-yard line. And that keeper ended by Tyrone Jones. Houston, 2 timeouts, and apparently no need to call either one. And Mack Brown has himself a 3-0 start with Texas Tech and Oklahoma coming up. Then the Demels team hung close for a half, but they fall 53-26. The final here in Houston. Again, coming up next, baseball tonight with Bill Pedo. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Dean Blevins, Holly Rowe, and our entire ESPN crew, Dave Barnett, so long from Houston.